banks of Jordan stood the great reformer John, and pointed to the Lamb of God, the long expected.
Hi there, my name is David Kenney. This is Light from Above. We're here on site at the Alexander Campbell home, the Campbell Mansion here in Bethany, West Virginia. Now, as we talk about some events here, it's very important that you keep in mind that we're talking about a period in our nation's history before the Civil War. And you can really see that when you look at the mansion, the fact that you can see it when you look at the roof. If you notice here, the first six windows, three on the top, three on the bottom, is the John Brown Mansion. That was the first part of the mansion that was built when Alexander Campbell came from Ireland. He settled a little bit of time in Washington, Pennsylvania. He married John Brown's daughter, and then he lived his whole life here in what was Buffalo, Virginia at the time. And so there's a lot of great historical things here that relates to our nation's history and also relates to church history. So we're excited to be here to be able to share some of these events with you. This was the home of Alexander Campbell, who was a noted preacher, debater, educator, writer, publisher, politician, farmer, and more. He and his father, Thomas Campbell, were part of a larger movement to abandon denominationalism and follow the New Testament without creeds, confessions of faith, and other denominational trappings. In his day, his name was known throughout the United States. This can be seen in the company that came to visit him here, men like Calhoun, Clay, Daniel Webster, Jefferson Davis, James A. Garfield, and others, names that perhaps have faded from memory. Alexander Campbell also founded Bethany College, which is the oldest degree-granting institution in the state of West Virginia. Keep in mind that this is a historical site. In fact, the Campbell Mansion, Old Main, and other buildings related to Bethany College have been declared National Historic Landmarks. We are thankful to Historic Bethany for giving us permission to record on location and provide you a glimpse into the life of one of America's greatest religious reformers in our nation's history, Alexander Campbell. Alexander Campbell was born, according to the family Bible, September 12, 1788, in Antrim, Ireland. His parents were Thomas and Jane Campbell. Both father and son were well-trained classical educators. When Alexander Campbell attempted to bring the family to join Thomas in America in 1808, the ship, the Hibernia, shipwrecked in Scotland. The family would eventually arrive safely to America, although not without difficulty, on the ship called the Latonia. That would be September 29, 1809. Alexander Campbell was 21 years of age when he came to the New World. He would eventually meet and marry Margaret Brown of Buffalo, Virginia. When he arrived in America, his father completed the declaration and address, which was about to be printed and mailed to all the churches in Washington County, Pennsylvania. They were united in their efforts to restore New Testament Christianity, and the Declaration and Address was very similar to the Declaration of Independence. In fact, L.L. Briggins once stated about the Declaration and Address, "Since the last Amen of Revelation was penned by John on the Isle of Patmos, it is doubtful if another religious document of equal importance has been written. The principles laid down in this address are as old as the New Testament and perhaps as true. They constitute the very foundation upon which the movement to restore the original faith and practice was launched." Alexander began living here when he married John Brown's daughter Margaret on March 12, 1811. The area was known as Buffalo, Virginia when Alexander Campbell came here. The name Buffalo still remains in the area, with the main water supply to this area being that of Buffalo Creek. On June 8, 1814, the Brush Run congregation decided to move their operation to Zanesville, Ohio. John Brown, Margaret's father — this is not John Brown the abolitionist — he did not like the prospect of having his daughter and two grandchildren moving so far away, so he ended that plan by deeding the mansion and the 300 farm to Alexander for $1 in 1815. John Brown then moved to Charlestown, 3 miles north, and began a grocery business. Today, Charlestown, Virginia, is Wellsburg, West Virginia. Since Alexander Campbell was not going forward with the plan to relocate, then neither was the rest of the Brush Run congregation. Later in 1820, John Brown would sell Alexander an additional 136 acres on Buffalo Creek for $1,360. This would bring Alexander Campbell's land holdings to around 436 acres. Alexander Campbell would remain in Buffalo, Virginia, Bethany, Virginia, and finally Bethany, West Virginia, all of his days. There are three main levels of the mansion. You have the upstairs, where Buffalo Seminary students live, and you have the main floor, which is a parlor and a bedroom for John Brown and his wife. It's also the place where the seminary operated out of. And then you have the basement, where the family lived. Now, the roof of the Campbell Mansion is tin, and the walls were made of wood, but the foundation is that of limestone. In the basement of the mansion was where Alexander, Margaret, and the children lived when he conducted Buffalo Seminary prior to the major addition to the mansion. All right, now when we start looking at the tour, we're actually going to go around the back side of the mansion, because down here behind this door here, we'll show you in a minute, is where the family lived for a while when Alexander Campbell married Margaret. He was a professional educator. Thomas and Alexander were both very classical educated educators, and they would actually teach some of the schools. They would teach different kinds of families and everything, people that could afford to have an education. This is before the time of public schools. Matter of fact, Alexander Campbell, when he was on the legislature in Virginia, was one of the first people to advocate the importance of having public education for everybody. Well, before that time, Alexander Campbell, since he was trained to be an educator, among other things, he actually taught his own school. And the earlier part of the mansion I showed you, the sixth window part of the Buffalo John Brown part of it, the family had to move down here while he operated the school out of the parlor and the upstairs bedrooms. So Margaret and the children would actually live in this section of the house, and we're real excited to be able to show it to you right now.
The blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb.
Well, we're downstairs in the Campbell Mansion, the John Brown Mansion part, the original part that was built. You have to keep in mind that the original mansion, when Alexander Campbell came here, which was owned by John Brown, Buffalo, Virginia, it was a three-story building. And this story here is the bottom level of the building. And Alexander Campbell, as I mentioned, was a professional educator. Him and his father ran schools, educated people, taught all kinds of different subjects. A lot of people sought them out to educate their children and things like that. So that's one of the things that Alexander Campbell sought out to do, was to establish a business of educating children and so and young people. So he established what he called Buffalo Seminary. Now, at this time, he's very limited on the facilities that he has at his disposal. So what has to happen in order to run an academy out of this mansion, which is what he has to work with, the family actually has to move down here into the bottom level. The middle level, what we'll call the old parlor, is where the classes would go on at the time. And then the top level would be dormitory-type bedrooms where the students would sleep. They'd provide room and board for their students. So it's a major operation, and the whole thing would have to be a major impact to the whole family. So Margaret and the children would have to move down here and live. Now, it's a nice area, and one of the things, make sure you notice, is the fireplace. The fireplace, we believe, has just about all original pieces in it. Because what happened through all the transitions that have been done to the mansion, this was actually bricked over at one point in time. And whoever did that put all the utensils in there and just basically bricked over all of it. And so when they were excavating it, they found all this the way that it was here. So all these are original pieces going back to who knows how long ago. But you want to make sure you notice that. There's bedrooms down here. Now, some people have the idea that Margaret lost a lot of children. Matter of fact, she lost two children during a period of time when they lived down here. They lived down here from 1818 to 1823, when Alexander Campbell would make the first major addition. That would allow her to move out of here. But during that time, they lost two children. And some people think that they probably lost them because of the conditions that are down here. But one thing to keep in mind, she had eight children, and none of her children lived to reach the age of 30. So whether or not it was because of the conditions here, probably had something to do with it, but probably wasn't the only cause of it. But as you can see down here, there's very nice accommodations for the time frame. Also, you want to keep in mind, this is a major source of heat for the mansion. So it would have been really warm down here, and it's not the worst place to stay, obviously, on the frontier days of our country. We're now leaving the lower level of the original mansion and going to the main entrance. In order to do that, we have to come back around to the front of the house and go in through the front door, and then turn to the right and enter what is now called the old parlor. The main floor of the original 1793 mansion included what is now called the old parlor. The floor is solid oak, and much of the wood elsewhere is believed to be that of walnut. It is believed this timber was cut and milled here right in this area. It would not be uncommon for family worship to occur here twice daily. First, family worship was generally around 7 o'clock in the morning, before breakfast. There would be Bible study, singing of hymns, offering of prayers, and also memorization would be a part of this worship together. The second service was after supper, and all were expected to attend. There are many interesting objects to take note of in this front room of the original John Brown part of the mansion. Hanging on the wall in the old parlor are portraits of various children of Alexander Campbell and Selina, and those of Margaret as well. The painter was William F. Cogswell of Pittsburgh. Now, if you're standing in the doorway of the old parlor and look to the right, the portraits on that wall from the entrance to the piano are those that Selina had. These names include Virginia Ann Campbell, Alexander Campbell Jr., Wycliffe Campbell, and Margaret Brown Campbell. Now, the two on the left are those from Margaret, and they are Marie Louisa Campbell and Lavinia Pendleton, Campbell Pendleton. The portrait of Clorinda was out for cleaning, and the restoration was being done while this film was being made. There are no known portraits by Cogswell of either Decima or William, both children of Selina. There may have been one made of Decima, but it's uncertain whether it survives, and no one really knows if one of William was ever made. In addition to the paintings, there are several other items of interest in the old parlor. These two cushions are believed to be the ones that Alexander and Margaret kneeled upon while they were being married. They were married in this room with a reception given by his parents, Thomas and Jane Campbell, in their home. Several of the Campbell's daughters were married here. Matter of fact, the old parlor is still a popular place to have ceremonies even to this day. Also, there's a piano, the R. Nuns Clark Rosewood Piano. It dates around 1838 to 1858. It has a 6-octave keyboard. It was purchased by Alexander Campbell and brought to Bethany with great effort. Being the first in Brook County, it crossed the mountains to be delivered. It was quite a novelty item for the time, and people would come to see it, just to see one, because a lot of people didn't have access to a piano. Now, while Alexander Campbell was opposed to instrumental music and worship to God, this does not mean that he was opposed to instrumental music outside of worship. In fact, during his day, none of the denominations used such instruments in worship. Only the instrument of the heart was used. This is a special recliner chair used by Thomas Campbell. He retired to Bethany Mansion after the death of his wife Jane in 1835. The chair was a gift from his daughters. In addition to the portraits of the children, there is a picture of one of Alexander Campbell's best friends, Walter Scott. Interestingly, Alexander met Scott about the time he was planning to publish his first journal. Alexander Campbell was going to call it The Christian, which I find rather ironic, but Walter Scott suggested that maybe the term Christian Baptist would be better, because there were a lot of Baptists in the area, and Walter Scott thought they would be more receptive to reading such a periodical. And so, because of Walter Scott's suggestion, the paper was called The Christian Baptist. There were many memories made in this room. Thomas Campbell's funeral was conducted here. While Alexander Campbell died in the room next door, across the hallway here, his body laid in state here, and visitors came and filed through the old parlor to pay their last respects to one of the great reformers and restoration leaders. It is said that a lot of people came and the lines were clear up the road. People had great love and respect for Alexander Campbell.
He paid all those who did repent.
Now, one of the fascinating things about Alexander Campbell and a lot of things that he stood for was the idea of the restoration plea, the idea of, you know, getting rid of creeds, getting rid of confessions of faith, getting rid of traditions and things that have built up over time, and actually go back to the New Testament, to restore ourselves back to the New Testament pattern. And one of the nice things about, a way to illustrate that is, it's this color blue here on the mantle and in the surrounding rooms here in the old parlor. It's an interesting story. Apparently, this color blue at one point in time became faded. And so Selina, Alexander Campbell's second wife, decided to paint it. And she painted it some kind of brown. Well, when you know how restoration people work, they want to try to restore as much of any project to the original day as they can. And they read in Selina's book how she had painted this over and how it used to be a color blue. So what they did was they actually came in and they actually scraped the brown off of this mantle and found that color blue. Now, that's interesting to think about. How would you go about restoring that color blue? There are all kinds of shades of blue out there. How would you get back as close as you could to the original? Well, they just scraped off that brown until they got a color they could match. And then they took that and they had it matched. And so this color is basically the color that it was back then. Of course, as we painted several years ago, it may not be exactly because of the age of the paint and all that. But this is what's called Williamsburg blue. And so they went back and they painted it and they restored the blue in this room to the room the way that it was when Alexander Campbell lived here. Now think about that. That's really significant because what we're saying when we say the restoration plea is the idea of we want to go back to the original church in the New Testament. Well, what did that look like? Well, we know what it looked like because of the New Testament. So when we read the New Testament and we say, okay, we got to get rid of some things because we have added things that just don't belong to the New Testament church. Well, that's like scraping that brown paint off. And then we say, okay, now that we know what it looked like, now we need to go and try to restore it within our own community. Well, that's what they did. They went and they identified the marks of the church. And they said, we know this is what it looks like. Now we need to go and we need to spread that throughout Christendom. And that's what Alexander Campbell did. So this color blue, Williamsburg blue, is a great illustration about what the restoration movement, the restoration plea is all about. And that is getting back to the New Testament and being a New Testament Christian and New Testament Christians making up the New Testament church. This is the room of Thomas Campbell's bedroom. It's a part of the original mansion of 1793 on the main floor. Originally, it was two rooms, but it was modified to be a single room. Thomas Campbell retired to live his remaining years with Alexander Campbell when his wife, Jane Cornagle Campbell, died on April 28, 1835. Thomas Campbell was born February 1, 1763, in Newry, County Down, Ireland. His father's name was Archibald. He was a former Roman Catholic, but became a member of the Anglican Church. His mother's name was Alice McNally. His parents never came to America. Thomas Campbell gravitated toward the Presbyterian Church, partly because of his father's attitude, but also because someone recognized Thomas Campbell's talents and abilities and provided him educational opportunities which led him to join the Presbyterian Church. An example of the power of Christian education in that it shaped his life. Interestingly, Thomas Campbell's wife, Jane Cornagle, was a descendant of the French Huguenots. People of this time frame were well aware of the persecutions between the Catholics and the Protestants. Emphasis on religious liberty was often found in the writings and lessons of Thomas and Alexander Campbell. In 1809, Thomas Campbell authored the Declaration and Address of Christian Association of Washington, which is a reference to Washington, Pennsylvania, when he first lived when coming to America. This document, along with the last will and testament of the Springfield Presbytery in 1804 from those at Cane Ridge, led by Barton W. Stone, ought to be read by everyone interested in what these men were attempting to do and how they were going about to accomplish it. Thomas Campbell died in this room on January 4, 1854, at the age of 90. He came to America in 1807 in an effort to extend his life. Thomas Campbell's life has several important lessons, but I would like to point out that he lost several children before his death. James lived 1789 to 1792. Nancy lived 1798 to 1841. Thomas Jr. lived from 1802 to 1842. Alicia Ann lived from 1806 to 1839. Plus two children they lost in childbirth they never named. Thomas Campbell was survived by children as well. He was survived by his first son, Alexander Campbell, 1788 to 1866. A daughter, Dorothea, 1793 to 1861. Daughter, Jane Cornagle, 1800 to 1871. Archibald William lived from 1804 to 1878. Thomas Campbell was a widower for 20 years. He kept serving the Lord through preaching, writing, editing, and the work that he did with Bethany College. He did not stop, and he would not stop, until blindness forced him to stop in 1848. But even then, he lived another 6 years. Even then, he was still quoting scriptures, singing hymns, worshiping, and working with the children at home. He never stopped serving the Lord. He's a great example of continual service throughout one's entire lifetime. Now, this is Thomas Campbell's bedroom. And Thomas Campbell's the one that wrote the Declaration and Address. He was one of the major leaders of the movement to go back to New Testament Christianity. And he would live out his life, and through his whole time, I mean, he lost several children in childbirth and also throughout his life. He would be a widower for about 20 years. He would eventually go into blindness before he passed away at the age 90. But through all that, he never stopped. He never quit. And he was very vital to the efforts that Alexander Campbell was making. Alexander Campbell would have to go across our country to preach at various locations. He had to write. He was an administrator of a college. He had a lot of responsibilities, not to mention just the managing of the farm and everything that was going on with that. He was an extremely busy individual. Well, Thomas Campbell was essential for Alexander to be able to do the work that Alexander did. You can talk a lot of things about how Thomas Campbell made contributions to the Restoration Movement. Perhaps one of the greatest contributions that he made was in the training of his son, Alexander Campbell. This is the room where he passed away. He passed away in this bed at the age of 90. And as I mentioned, he was blind, and there's a small bed here where his grandson, Willie, would take care of him, of his needs as he needed. And he was active all the way until the end of his days. Now we'll go to the upstairs, to the top level of the John Brown Mansion, to see the bedrooms that were also used to house the students of Buffalo Seminary. We're up in the original part of the mansion, the 1793 part of John Brown's mansion. Alexander Campbell, Margaret moved in here, lived here. And this is the part of the original bedroom. It's gone through several different reconfigurations. It's believed when they ran Buffalo Seminary out of here, it probably had three different rooms in it. And eventually, as they would make the addition, which you'll see in a little bit, this allowed the family to return back to their bedrooms, and they were able to return to life on a more degree of normalcy than they had, obviously, when they were living down in the basement of the mansion. And so this is one of the major rooms upstairs in that mansion, and it's a very important area. The children lived here, grew up here. They had a nurse that took care of them, and this was the area that they resided in whenever they had to sleep and things like that. There's several interesting things in this room, but one thing I want to point out doesn't really necessarily have anything to do with this being a bedroom, but this is Alexander Campbell's writing chair, one of his several chairs that he had. And this particular one, if you notice, it has a drawer here that opens up, and it would actually hold a book. And it's not hard to guess what book would be in there. It was Alexander Campbell's Bible. And so this would be his writing chair. He'd have a Bible there. And so they would call this the Bible chair. And it's interesting, it had it restored. And I was just looking at the marker here, and it says, restored as a tribute to the Church of Christ at Shelby, Ohio. And so it's a very important piece of furniture in among the mansion. And it's interesting, I've read that when Alexander passed away, of course, Selena was devastated, that she would often take this chair all the way up to Campbell's grave, and she would sit out there and read and reflect. And it's not exactly an easy chair to maneuver with, but she would drag it up there and she would sit and think about the days that she had with her husband, Alexander Campbell. So this is Alexander Campbell's Bible chair, and this is the original bedroom of the mansion in 1793. Now this is one of the smaller bedrooms upstairs. We're still in the original John Brown mansion of 1793. As I mentioned before, the house would go through several different configurations that they would make to accommodate whatever they were doing at the time, whether it's running a seminary, having a family, things of that nature. And this room is believed to be the room that was occupied by Elizabeth Patterson. Selena would call her Dear Eliza. The children called her Aunt Betsy. Now, she was a lady that was hired to come and work with the family. She worked with this family for around 40 years. And she was practically a part of the family. And this is a room that is believed to be her quarters, that where she could reach the children. The original bedroom is just to my right. And this is the room that they believe that she had occupied. And it's interesting, you know, a lot of names change around towns in this time frame. I mentioned she was from Wellsburg, Virginia, but back in that day, it's actually Wellsburg, West Virginia. In that day, it was Charlestown, Virginia. So when you have these different town names and everything, you might come across the name of a town that's different because of, you know, at this time, there is no West Virginia, it's all Virginia. And so you have to keep that in mind. But this is the room that she occupied. She worked with them for 40 years. She's a cherished member of the family, and she's actually buried in God's Acre Cemetery, and we'll show you that later. But people are curious about, did Alexander Campbell own slaves? And yes, he did, and that's what I want to talk about for a few minutes here. The fact that Alexander Campbell owned and purchased slaves is no secret. Now, Elizabeth Patterson was not a slave. She was a white woman hired to help Selina with the children and the management of household affairs. I would like to make a few comments about Alexander Campbell and slavery. First of all, I would encourage you to keep in mind the historical time frame at which Alexander Campbell lived. He lived before the Civil War. Alexander Campbell did not support slavery. However, he did recognize that the New Testament regulated the practice, and that if the New Testament was followed, it would gradually lead to emancipation. The challenge is that of the abolitionists, of which I consider myself aligned, sometimes don't recognize the other views of slavery. There were three basic views of slavery of the period. There was the abolitionist view, and then there were those who were actually in favor of slavery, and then there was a third option that people often don't even consider or don't even know about, and that was called gradualism. People tend to think you are either for slavery or against it. Alexander Campbell was against slavery, but he differed with the abolitionists on how to eradicate it. Alexander Campbell was a gradualist at first, but he was never pro-slavery. Keep in mind that giving slaves freedom, while noble and right, did not exactly help them, as there was no public education or other tools to help them survive in the world that they were brought to by force. When Alexander Campbell went to the Virginia Assembly, he wanted to advocate two things. First, the abolition of slavery, and second, free public education. He was able to make one of the first appeals for public education for everybody for free, which certainly would also be vital for the slaves if they would be freed as well. The climate at the Virginia Assembly made it plain to him that discussion about the abolition of slavery among Virginia plantation owners would be futile. Also consider this. James A. Garfield came to visit Bethany to consider attending school here, but he declined because it was not aligned with the abolitionist viewpoint at the time. So Garfield decided to go to Williams and Mary College instead. Now, when you see his interactions with Alexander Campbell, you come to realize that Campbell certainly was not pro-slavery. In fact, pro-slavery advocates wrote materials attacking Campbell for his efforts to form an abolitionist-type party in the state of Kentucky. It is easy to pass judgment on prior generations from our own vantage point, but let me caution you about that. I detest slavery. I am proud that my descendants served in the Ohio militia in an effort to force its eradication. That being said, imagine this scenario. You have a family that is being sold on the open market. You have the financial means to purchase them, to provide them living quarters, food, education and training, and other things that they will need to survive and to live. You could provide them their freedom. Now ask yourself, would you do this? Some argue that Alexander Campbell only inherited slaves from his father-in-law, John Brown, but that is not the entire picture. He did purchase two slaves from a Methodist preacher nearby, and they were named James and Charlie Poole. They were brothers of ages 18 and 20. Alexander did not have to purchase them, but he did so. He provided for them, promised to give them their independence at the age of 28, an action that was actually illegal in the state of Virginia at the time. This process is sometimes called manumission. He fulfilled his promise to them. The men were grateful and remained on to work with Alexander Campbell as free men. Charlie Poole lived to see the death of Alexander Campbell while his brother died prior. Also, do you realize that a freed black man changed his name to Alexander Campbell because he wanted to do among the blacks what Alexander Campbell had done among the religious people of his day? This is a difficult time in our nation's history, as shown by the fact that it would lead us into the Civil War. Imagine how many lives could have been spared if we had worked together to prepare slaves for their freedom and gave them emancipation. Do you know that in 1832, Alexander Campbell submitted a proposal suggesting a plan for emancipation since the federal debt for the War of 1812 was paid off? He suggested $10 million annually be given until all the slaves were purchased, educated and trained and then liberated throughout the land. The cost of the Civil War? Total deaths, 618,000. And one source estimated the cost to the Union alone averaged $2.5 million a day. When one looks at the cost of the Civil War, which lasted 4 years in lives, dollars, and capital, and compares it to the gradualist emancipation's plan, it does give one reason to pause. There are basically two rooms, part of the original homestead upstairs, the Barclay room and this room. This is the Campbell genealogy room. It serves for a lot of the genealogical research that relates to the Campbell family. It includes research relating to God's Acre Cemetery too. Much of the research done here was completed by George F. Miller, who passed away April 2, 2009, and is also buried in God's Acre himself. On the main wall, you will notice two groupings. The one centerpiece of a grouping contains a fact card about Margaret Brown, Alexander Campbell's first wife. Radiating around her fact card are the children she bore to Alexander. The other centerpiece is Selena Huntington Bakewell Campbell, Alexander Campbell's second wife. And radiating from her fact card are the children she bore to Alexander Campbell as well. As I am sure you may know, it is not uncommon for children to die at birth. It was also not uncommon for the mother to die giving birth to her children. In fact, Margaret Brown's mother died giving birth to her. Her father, John Brown, remarried December 4, 1797, when Margaret was 6 years old. He married Anne Glass of Charlestown, Virginia, now Wellsburg, West Virginia, who reared Margaret. Margaret had another older stepsister, and her name was Jane. It was to Jane that Margaret exclaimed the first time she saw Alexander Campbell on his way to the mansion to deliver some books to her father, "Look, Jane, here comes my future husband." In the genealogy room, in addition to the things that are here to study, to learn about as far as the family and all that, are some interesting artifacts that you can explore and look at as well. One of them I want to point out is this tombstone. This is actually Thomas Campbell's original tombstone. It turns out somebody had stolen it out of the cemetery, probably some kind of prank, and actually took it with them. And then a young boy found it playing baseball in a field out in Wheeling. Ashley found it, and he could read it, and he knew that it was important from what he could read, and contacted Bethany and got the stone back to the rightful place. And when we go out to the cemetery and see where Thomas Campbell is buried, they put a replacement stone out there because they thought this would be lost forever. And then when it came back, they decided that it would be better to keep it in here, to keep it safe, because it really is a major piece of history. And just what I thought I would do is just read a little bit to you from it. Some of it I had to write down because I can't make it out on the stone. But it says, Thomas Campbell, father of Alexander and Archibald Campbell. And then it goes on to say, born in County Down, Ireland, February 1st, 1763, and died at the residence of his son, Alexander, January 4th, 1854. Age 91 years, 11 months, and 5 days. Many years, the minister of the Secession Presbyterian Church in Ireland and Scotland, in the United States upon the arrival of his family in America in 1809, who withdrew from the Presbyterian community and advocated a platform of primitive Christianity in conjunction with his son, Alexander. He labored in this with much success. More than 40 years of Christian learning and piety, he had few equals as a Christian minister, husband, father, few superiors, strong in faith and hope. He triumphed over death and reposes in Jesus without a sorrow or fear. Happy are the dead who die in the Lord, for they rest from their labors and their works do follow them. So as you can see, you know, this stone isn't just documenting when he lived and died, but it really tells the story of what Thomas Campbell is really about. It's really a testament to the things that he set out to do. The Campbells weren't interested in founding another denomination. They were calling people out of denominationalism. They themselves had already been a part of denominationalism. Why would they go back into that? And this stone is an important piece of history, and it's a very major testament to the life that Thomas Campbell lived. Now, the other bedroom that is in the upstairs of the John Brown Mansion is used to display items largely related to Alexander Campbell's daughter, Decima, and the work of the American Christian Missionary Society. We are in the section that was added by Alexander Campbell in 1819 to accommodate the growing Buffalo Seminary. The upstairs was made into dormitory-style bedrooms to provide the room and board for students of the seminary school. This addition also facilitated relocating the family out of the basement of the mansion too. When Buffalo Seminary closed, the room was still a bedroom, probably used to accommodate guests who would arrive prior to the days of the construction of Strangers Hall. Today, this bedroom is used to showcase memorabilia relating to Decima Campbell Barclay's in-laws, James Turner Barclay and Julia Ann Sowers Barclay, who were the first foreign missionaries set out from the American Christian Missionary Society, or the ACMS. In 1849, the ACMS was established. Its first convention was held in Cincinnati, and Alexander Campbell was elected president in absentia. He was unable to attend due to illness, as it was reported. Since Decimus' father was supportive of this missionary effort, it is not surprising to see such an exhibit here in the mansion. Now, one of the interesting individuals' portraits in this room is this picture here by James Turner Barclay. James Turner Barclay was one of the first missionaries to come out from the American Christian Missionary Society. She's actually Decima Campbell Barclay's father-in-law. And it's interesting, the Barclays used to actually own Monticello, Jefferson's home, and their son, John Judson, was actually born in Monticello, and John Judson Barclay is the one that married Decima Barclay, and she lived here. She survived him. He lived here for a while. He passed away here at Campbell Mansion, but she lived and survived him as well. And this is a picture of James Turner Barclay. And there's other pictures here that are significant to the Barclay family as we talk about the American Christian Missionary Society. Again, he was one of those missionaries, and he actually went over to Jerusalem and Israel and served over there on two different occasions. Some were and still are opposed to the missionary society concept. I would include myself in that group that would be opposed to such an institution. Still, some charge that Alexander Campbell's early writings, particularly in the Christian Baptist, were inconsistent with his later writings and actions relating to the American Christian Missionary Society. It is not a charge without some merit. Some seek to reconcile this discrepancy by claiming he never really supported the ACMS financially in his will. However, he did give the rights to his hymnal to the ACMS to raise funds in 1864, before his death. Some suggest that his judgment was impaired by the death of Wycliffe on September 4, 1847. Now, while Wycliffe's death certainly had an impact on him, one would have to call all of Alexander Campbell's activities into question at that time, plus all his activities up to the time of his own death in 1866. He wrote in support of the Missionary Society in the Millennial Harbinger between 1841 and 1848, and even as early as 1831 he stated,
"A church can do what an individual disciple cannot, and so can a district of churches do what a single congregation cannot." Millennial Harbinger, 1831.
Notice that this preceded Wycliffe's drowning by 16 years, which dispels the theory that this support for the ACMS was related to the drowning of his son. Alexander Campbell served as president of the American Christian Missionary Society every year until his death, a period between 1849 and 1866. Plus, his book, Popular Lectures and Addresses, published in 1863, contains three addresses to the ACMS. He clearly supported societies both in word, action, and deed. As to whether Alexander Campbell was inconsistent in his early writings when it came to the ACMS, I will leave for others to discuss that. Interestingly, Alexander Campbell denied that he was inconsistent. And when you look at the record of his actions, you can see what he meant by it. Alexander Campbell was an active member of the Redstone Baptist Association from 1813 to 1822 and the Mahoning Association from 1823 to 1830. When the Mahoning Association voted to dissolve, Alexander Campbell was not exactly excited about that decision, but he did not stop its dissolution. When you examine the operation of these associations, their own constitutions, church delegates, society meeting notes, communications issued to participating churches, collecting money for missionary and other projects, lessons presented, etc., one can see the challenge. My theory is that Alexander Campbell desired the infrastructure, the bureaucracy, if you will, as a way to facilitate communication, cooperation, and administration from a vantage point greater than the one a local congregation provided him at the time. Perhaps he was looking for a way to spread the word about the principles of the Declaration Address and consider this course as a way to help spread these principles. Now, not to debate the issue here, but to state that Alexander Campbell was inconsistent with his later writings and actions compared with his earlier actions may be difficult to establish. Over time, the opposition to missionary societies grew to the point that even those who originally thought it was a good idea would end up being critics to the concept. For example, Benjamin Franklin and others. It would do well for us to remember that Alexander Campbell is not the authority in these matters. The New Testament is the authority. One additional comment I'll make about the children outfits in the upstairs. Do not think that these were christening dresses for infant baptism. Alexander Campbell debated against pedobaptism, that's a name for children baptism, in three of his major debates. He had debates with John Walker, William McCullough, and Nathaniel Rice, and he never baptized, he never performed infant baptism on his children. This large dining room was made to serve a great array of visitors that came to the Campbell mansion. Alexander Campbell would sit at the head of the table closest to the front door, while Selena would sit at the other end of the table in order to be close to the kitchen and to be able to serve others. Contrary to what some might suspect, Alexander Campbell did have a good sense of humor. Although the story is difficult to document, I can recall being told about it. The story is told of two college students who were mocking Alexander and Selena Campbell, looking at a rooster and a hen out in the yard, and they would say, "Well, there's Mr. Campbell, and there's Mrs. Campbell," and Alexander Campbell saw them doing that, and they didn't realize that he had seen them. So he decided to invite them for dinner. Now, to be invited to the president's mansion for dinner was a high honor, so they were shocked that they would be even invited to such a thing. And when they sat down for dinner, there was chicken served. And when the boys had finished their first round, Alexander Campbell grabbed the chicken and asked them, "Would you like to have some more? How about some more of Mr. Campbell? Or maybe some more of Mrs. Campbell?" So you see, Alexander Campbell did have a very good sense of humor. Now, in the Campbell dining room, there's a lot of interesting things here. The dining room table, for one, would seat anywhere from 30 to 60 people, depending on the amount of guests they'd have, and they'd make the accommodations in order to accommodate them. One thing that is interesting you have to keep in mind, we're talking about pre-Civil War period. So you're talking about a time before fast food, before chain stores, before chain hotels, things like that. So when people came to the Campbell Mansion, they would often spend quite a bit of time here, sometimes days, weeks, or even months. And so they had quite an oppressive array of visitors. Alexander Campbell was a very predominant man in the nation and in politics as well. Matter of fact, in this portrait right here, which you can see, this is the 1829 Virginia Constitutional Convention. And Alexander Campbell is a delegate from Brook County, and he is right here in among these people. And you have James Madison and different ones in this portrait. He did serve in politics, and that's something that's important to note. When he was a part of that convention, one of the things that he wanted to advocate was the abolition of slavery. He wanted to do away with slavery. He was opposed to slavery and wanted to do away with it. But you got to keep in mind, at this time, West Virginia is Virginia, and you have the whole eastern part of the state that had plantation owners, and it wasn't in their interest or to abolish slavery. So even though he would like to abolish slavery in Virginia, he didn't have the votes to do it. Another interesting thing that he wanted to advocate, and he did, was public education for everybody, rich or poor. There were people, there were aristocrat-type people that thought that education should only be for the people of affluence. Alexander Campbell didn't agree with that. Matter of fact, he was of the mindset that it's in the nation's best interest for its ultimate survival as a republic that everybody receive a first-class education. And he's one of the early advocates for what we know as public education today. There is an interesting statement that Alexander Campbell makes about voting he made in the Millennial Harbinger of 1857. In that, he stated, "In our country and government, every man is responsible for his vote. When, therefore, in his horizon there is a question of a crisis involving, as he judges, any good or the prevention of any evil, it is his duty to God who gives him a vote, and it is his duty to man to use or to give that vote to that person or to that measure which will, in his judgment, inure to the most good, or of two evils to prevent the greater by voting for the less." As part of the 1839 expansion, a full-size pantry was added off the side of the dining room with quick access to the kitchen. This would be needed to facilitate the operation of not only special guests, but college-related activities as well. Because you also have a full farm operation, too, you had to have plenty of foodstuffs on hand to be able to prepare meals for who knows how many guests they would have to be a part of the dinner of that evening. This area was an enclosed breezeway, probably to separate the heat from the kitchen activity from that of the dining room. For several years, this served as a gift shop area where I toured the mansion as a younger person during the tours that were conducted by George Miller, who is buried near Alexander Campbell's grave in God's Acre. The new kitchen was added around 1839. It is much larger than the kitchen that operated down in the basement that we looked at the beginning of our documentary. Now, Selena had a live-in cook and two cook assistants that she needed to operate this aspect of the work of the mansion. Being the wife of the college president, it is certainly probable she had no difficulty finding students to assist with the operation of the kitchen when the need arose. On the other side are two smaller ovens. They were probably used to keep dishes warm while people were being served or while other parts of the meal were being prepared. This is Stranger's Hall. Incidentally, the Campbells didn't really name it that. Actually, somebody in town did. They referred to it Stranger's Hall, and the family heard about it, and they liked it, and so the name just sort of stuck. So this is probably one of my favorite rooms in the mansion. It's the latest addition that they made, the last addition they made, as far as I know. And the main attraction about this room, besides the guests that they had, which we'll talk a little bit more about later, but it's actually the wallpaper behind me. The scene is from Telemachus, and some of you may be familiar with that. It was actually written by a Frenchman based on Homer's work, The Odyssey, and he expanded upon it, and it's a French work. And so this is a scene. You may think it's a painting, but it's actually wallpaper. And the story goes that Alexander Campbell was visiting Andrew Jackson in Hermitage, and he saw the wallpaper, and Alexander Campbell had a pretty good sense of humor, and it reminded him of a story. And the story, he was studying Telemachus. His father assigned it to him, and the Campbells were multilingualists. They knew French, they knew Latin, they knew Greek, they knew more than one language. And so when Alexander was studying under his father assigned him to read this story. And Alexander Campbell went out, and it was a nice sunny day. He was laying underneath the shade of a tree, and he's supposed to be reading his French work, his school work, and he fell asleep. And the story goes, a cow came and basically just snatched it off the top of his chest while he was sleeping. And before Alexander knew what was going on, the cow had actually swallowed his homework. So he had to go and explain to his father what happened, and his father chastised him and said, that cow has more French in its stomach than you have in your head. So that scene, that childhood memory, when Alexander Campbell visited Andrew Jackson Hermitage, Andrew Jackson told him where he could order it. It came from Paris. It was a very popular design at the time. The design's actually destroyed. I think it's a fire, probably caused most likely from World War I. And so they can't replicate it. There's only a few rooms in the United States that actually has this pattern. Incidentally, I'll mention the piano. The piano belonged to Decima, Alexander Campbell's 10th daughter. And this was a wedding gift that he gave her. It's a Steinway piano. And this piano has been all over the place. The Barclays, it was Decima Campbell Barclay, they were ambassadors of Cyprus for a time. So they actually took this piano all the way to Cyprus, and it's been to other places as well. So the piano is significant because of that as well. But there are a lot of great pieces of information, a lot of history here, a lot of people visited here that we would be very fascinated to sit down and have a conversation with today. Because a lot of people sought out Alexander Campbell because he wasn't just called the Sage of Bethany for no reason. There was a large bay window which was added by Decima Campbell Barclay after Alexander's death. In order to preserve the structure of this room, it was taken out and replaced with a more conventional window of the time. There was a fire in Stranger's Hall which did damage the wallpaper next to the fireplace. The wallpaper is irreplaceable, so they sought a pattern that would not stick out so much, and they found one that's called the West Point on Parade. It's a pattern developed by Gene Zuber, and it was a very close match, and so they were able to put this wallpaper in its place, and it basically preserves the overall feel of Stranger's Hall. Behind Stranger's Hall seating parlor are two bedrooms. One of the bedrooms once included a door at one time that led to an outdoor bathroom, an outhouse, if you will, or a privy. These two bedrooms were part of the 1840 addition. This particular bedroom has a bed in it that is called the President's Bed because it was a favored room by James A. Garfield, who slept here on more than one occasion. It has also been occupied by other leaders such as Henry Clay and even Jefferson Davis. One point to keep in mind that when Alexander Campbell passed away in 1866, James A. Garfield would not become the 20th President of the United States until 1881, some 15 years later. Of course, Garfield was an up-and-coming star, if you will. Prior to Campbell's death, he was elected to the Ohio State Senate, 1859, but would only serve 2 years before entering the Union Army as a lieutenant colonel. He would obtain the rank of brigadier general later in 1862, and in 1862 he was elected to the Congress as a representative of Ohio's 19th district, which led him to relocate from Ohio to Washington, D.C. But even before his political career, Thomas Campbell, Alexander Campbell, James A. Garfield, they all knew each other, they all worked together, and they were friends, and so it wouldn't be uncommon for James Garfield to be found visiting Bethany College at any time throughout the history of Alexander Campbell. Now, in this part of Strangers Hall, there's several interesting things. One of the things I want to point out is this chair. This is President Garfield's favorite chair. Of course, he wasn't president at the time. That would come later. But Garfield was a family friend. He was also an attorney for the Campbell family. And this is the chair that he preferred to sit in. And so they call that today the Garfield chair. Also, you have this chair here, which I think is called a pulpit chair. And both of these have been refinished and everything. And I think it's horsehair is what they're embroidered with. And then you have the mantle. It's a very beautiful mantle and a portrait of Alexander Campbell here. Now, as I mentioned before, a lot of people would come and talk to Alexander Campbell about all kinds of different issues or things that they were struggling with or just to discuss matters. In 1829, he debated a man by the name of Robert Owen. Now, Robert Owen was what we would call today a utopian socialist. He would be a forerunner to people like Karl Marx and different ones. But Campbell debated him, but before he debated him, Owen came out here and visited and said that the grounds and everything, that this area of the country, he said, there's no more beautiful place like this anywhere in Scotland. He was from Scotland, so he really fell in love with this place. And Owen and Campbell became friends, even though they were very diametrically opposed in their views of, you know, whether it's socialism or Christianity. And they debated, and it's really an important debate. If you want to talk about the idea of Christianity and socialism and them being compatible, you really ought to read that debate. If you want to talk about our nation's future, whether or not we're going to be more socialistic, more secular driven, you ought to read that debate because Alexander Campbell represented Christianity. A lot of people didn't want to debate Owen. Some of them were intimidated by him. But Alexander Campbell rose to the challenge, met him here, debated him. And then there was a time after the debate was over, that Robert Owen came back here. And they had a friendship and they were talking and everything. And Alexander Campbell pleaded with Owen to obey the gospel. He said he couldn't prove the things that of his socialism to be valid, and he couldn't refute what Alexander Campbell was teaching. And it said that he just put his head in his hands and just cried. He just would not repent. He would not listen. But they remained friends for as long as they lived. A lot of people have come to this place and sought out the wisdom and advice of Alexander Campbell. This is the addition made in 1819 that accommodated the growing Buffalo Seminary activity. This addition facilitated Margaret and the family to be able to return from the basement to the regular part of the mansion. For all you construction aficionados, this two-story addition was actually prefabricated, pre-built in Pittsburgh. Then it was disassembled, shipped down the Ohio River to Wellsburg, transported by ox cart, and then reassembled here in Bethany. Quite a feat for 1819. When Buffalo Seminary was in operation, which would be January 1818 to December 1822, this room actually ran the entire length of the mansion. Alexander sought to train people for the ministry, hence the name seminary, but students would go on to pursue other professional occupations. In 1823, Alexander Campbell decided to close Buffalo Seminary to focus on his next venture, the Christian Baptist. The Christian Baptist was published from 1823 to 1830, and it had a very explicit purpose as laid out in the prospectus on March 12, 1823, and set out for the following advertising.
The Christian Baptist shall espouse the cause of no religious sect excepting that ancient sect called Christians First at Antioch. Its sole object shall be the eviction of truth and the exposing of error in the doctrine and practice. The editor, acknowledging no standard of religious faith or works other than the Old and New Testament, and the latter as the only standard of the religion of Jesus Christ, will intentionally at least oppose nothing which it contains and recommend nothing which it does not enjoin. Having no worldly interest at stake, from the adoption or reprobation of any articles of faith or religious practice, having no gift or religious emolument.
As mentioned prior, Alexander Campbell's original title for the Christian Baptist was The Christian, but his good friend Walter Scott suggested adding the name Baptist to it in order to boost readership. It worked, and in more ways than one. His debates with John Walker in 1820 at Mount Pleasant, Ohio, and William McCullough in 1823 in Washington, Kentucky, on the proper subjects of baptism, believing adults, not infants, and the mode of baptism, immersion, not sprinkling or pouring, helped spread his fame and drive subscriptions. When Alexander Campbell completed the Christian Baptist, he replaced it with the Millennial Harbinger, which continued until after his death. He desired the change primarily because he was concerned that some would abuse the title Christian Baptist by making it a name for a denomination. Alexander Campbell did not seek to establish a denomination and took even this effort to prohibit such an act. When Buffalo Seminary closed in 1823, Alexander Campbell divided this first floor area. This area became his bedroom. The other area on the first floor addition would be the new dining room. The dining room would be expanded and a new kitchen added in 1830. The cradle was made by John Brown and was used for all the Campbell children and was even used by grandchildren and great-grandchildren. The saddlebags are the ones he used while he served as postmaster for Bethany, Virginia. He maintained this position for many years, only resigning a year or so before his death. When Alexander Campbell first lived here, the mail had to be retrieved from West Liberty, which was about 4 miles away. As his correspondence increased, handling the mail was more laborious. Desiring to shorten this distance and capitalize on franking privileges of being postmaster, which provided free postage, Alexander Campbell petitioned the state of Virginia to have a post office established in Buffalo, offering to carry the mail twice a week without charge. However, the law prohibited having a post office in two towns with the same name within the state. There was already a town named Buffalo in Mason County, Virginia, so Alexander Campbell changed the name of the town to Bethany and was appointed postmaster on June 2, 1827. He would serve as postmaster until 1865, nearly till his death. This allowed him to keep the distribution and subscription costs to the Christian Baptist and the Millennial Harbinger at a minimum, which also increased its distribution as well. The grandfather clock is from Wellsburg, West Virginia, and was used as part of Buffalo Seminary. This was Margaret Campbell's treasure. It is an 8-day clock made of rosewood with a moon-faced ornament. The clock marks minutes, hours, days, months, and phases of the moon. The grandfather clock was believed to be acquired in 1814. The reason it is so close to the ceiling is the ceiling was added sometime later. It is said that this clock has never left this room, and Decima went further to say at one point that if the mansion was to catch on fire and be consumed, the clock should never be moved, even if it burned in the fire.
Now I see the blood of the Lamb.
All right, this is the bed that Alexander Campbell passed away in. The shawl is his wife Selena's. This is her shawl that she made. And Alexander Campbell passed away on March 4th, 1866. He lived all the way until 11:45 in the evening on a Sunday, and he breathed his last here. There's stories about him reciting from memory several verses of scripture and other passages. And he passed away here, and Alexander Campbell was actually placed in a coffin. He laid in state in the old parlor for 3 days where people came to pay their respects. It's before the time of funeral homes, before funeral homes were common. We tend to take those things for granted today. And so people came from Bethany College. They came from the surrounding areas. As news traveled, outpourings of affection from various people from various quarters would come. and pay their respects for Alexander Campbell and the things that he accomplished here in Bethany. Now, when they had the funeral was delivered, the eulogy, the service was delivered by Robert Richardson. Robert Richardson is also the biographer. He wrote the memoirs of Alexander Campbell, and we'll show you his grave at a later time in the program. But it's said that the place was packed. Now, we have been throughout the mansion, and I'm sure have gotten the feel for it. There's at least 25 rooms in this mansion, and they're saying that the place was filled. It says that Robert Richardson actually had to deliver the funeral right outside this door here. The old part is across the hall. This is a part of the addition that Alexander Campbell made that helped Margaret and her family get out of the basement, so to speak, and be able to live their lives normally again. This is Buffalo Seminary. So Robert Richardson delivered this sermon. They had people outside in the front in the yard, and so he had to speak loud enough for people to hear, not only inside, but also to the people outside, because there was a great swell of people that came, and the correspondence would come for months in the Millennial Harbinger. Reports would come in, people made all kinds of declarations, all kinds of outpourings of tribute and praise for Alexander Campbell. And as I said, he passed away on this bed on March 4th, 1866. This bust was made from a death mask created after Alexander Campbell had passed away. It gives a good representation of what Alexander Campbell appeared like at the end of his life.
Now I see the blood of the Lamb.
All right, welcome to Brush Run. Brush Run is located about 10 miles southeast of Bethany, and it's about the same distance northwest of Washington, Pennsylvania. Now, Washington, Pennsylvania is where Thomas and Alexander Campbell lived about the time that this congregation would start. It's the place where the Declaration Address would be printed and distributed throughout this area of the country. It's a very significant spot. In the summer of 1809 is when Thomas Campbell withdrew from the Presbyterian Church and sought out to, on the path to go back to New Testament Christianity. And so it wouldn't be uncommon for them to, you know, pretty soon they're going to establish their own congregation. At first they were known as the Christian Association, the First Church of Christ of the Christian Association of Washington County, Pennsylvania. Well, as time would go by, they eventually become known as the Brush Run Church of Christ. And so they started here, they appointed deacons here, they started building a building here, and the building is no longer here. It was a portable building. They moved it from this site, and this marker commemorates the spot where the building stood. There used to be, when I was younger, there used to be foundational stones out here. You had a general idea of what the building looked like, at least the lay of the land. But those stones are gone now, and this marker is the only thing that's here that really commemorates this site. There's a lot of significant things that happened here. This is the site where the disciples decided that, based on their study of the New Testament, that they needed to observe the Lord's Supper every first day of the week. And that's what they started doing that here. They started doing it when they started worshiping here. This is also the place where people started, they wanted to be baptized. It's said that the congregation here started out with about 30 people. Alexander Campbell was the minister for the congregation. Thomas Campbell, some others were the elders, and they had deacons. And they started worshiping here together and on their path to being a New Testament church. The timber was milled from David Bryant's mill nearby by his two sons. Also, the limestone for the foundation was available from a quarry nearby. The construction contract was made by Thomas Sharp, and the builder's name was John Boyd. It was a simple wooden building held together by wooden pegs on a stone foundation. The building was 35 feet long, 18 feet wide, and had a 13-foot tall ceiling. The interior was unfinished and did not have a furnace. When the weather would turn excessively cold, they would sometimes meet in other members' homes. Even though the building was not elaborate, one estimate was at $400, the congregants were poor and unable to complete the payment as per the contract. John Boyd filed suit for payment, and the matter was settled on May 9, 1814, with a final payment of $98.98. There were still those who continued meeting at the former location, sometimes called Crossroads, if it was advantageous for them to do so. The congregation decided to have its first service there on the new property before the building was completed. A temporary stand was put in place under a shade tree, and on September 16, 1810, Alexander Campbell delivered the first sermon there on the site. He chose as his passage Job 8, verse 7, which reads,
"Though thy beginning was small, yet thy latter end shall be greatly increased."
Another service on May 5, 1811, they worshiped and observed communion. Alexander preached on John 6, 48-58, and Thomas Campbell preached on Romans 8, 32. 2 acres were donated by William and Jane Calchrist. You might see this spelled as Gilchrist or Gilchrist or Gilchrest, from their property for the building. The deed was made for $1, included provisions for a church graveyard and even a seminary. It was restricted from any other purposes. Incidentally, Abraham Alters was one of Alexander Campbell's early ministerial students. The deed was made September 27, 1810. Representing the church were Alexander Campbell as minister, John Sharp Jr., Abraham Alters as trustee and successor. Other members were also a part of it too. The building was finished enough on June 16, 1811. The Brush Run Church began weekly observance of the Lord's Supper from this point forward, based on their study of the New Testament church of the first century, as recorded in Acts 20, verse 7, and 1 Corinthians 16, verse 2. There were 30 charter members of this congregation at Brush Run, and here's a list of those names of people. The list must have been made before Margaret Brown had married Alexander Campbell, as she is not listed. They were married on March 12, 1811. Weekly observance was not the only change that would come about at Brush Run Church of Christ. The subject of sprinkling and infant baptism was discussed prior to the Declaration Address's printing. As people studied their New Testaments and sought to follow what it stated rather than their creeds, they began to request immersion. 3 people requested immersion on July 4, 1811. Joseph Bryant, who would later marry Dorothea Campbell, Abraham Alters, and Margaret Fullerton, all charter members. They were baptized on the farm of David Bryant in shoulder-deep water on Buffalo Creek, about 2 miles up from the mouth of Brush Run. Thomas Campbell baptized them from a large tree root. He did not go into the water himself, but he immersed them from that position. Others would come to request immersion, and those who decided not to be immersed eventually removed themselves from the congregation. Although others were being immersed, the Campbells had not been at this point themselves. This illustrates that working oneself out of a denominational type of thinking is not as easily done as some might think, a lesson that we should have patience and forbearance towards others while they learn the truth for themselves, and that we try to help them to the best of our ability. On June 8, 1814, the members of Brush Run Church decided it best to relocate to Zanesville because of the lack of prospects in the area. However, John Brown, Margaret Brown's father, stopped that plan by giving the mansion and the farm to Alexander and Margaret. Incidentally, Alexander Campbell became a U.S. citizen on February 27, 1815. The date of the deed was March 15, 1815. On September 2, 1815, the Brush Run Church was admitted to the Redstone Baptist Association based on invitation probably initiated by Matthias Luce, who was a member of it. This association did not require congregations to adhere to the Philadelphian Confession of Faith, so Brush Run was able to write its own stipulations for admittance. When tensions boiled over, the association would change their constitution to close this loophole. However, it would have dire consequences for the Redstone Baptist Association, as many other supporters of the doctrines of Alexander Campbell and others would leave. At the annual meeting of the Redstone Baptist Association at Cross Creek in Brooke County, Virginia, from August 30th to September 1st, 1816, Brush Run reported a total membership of 26. Alexander Campbell was asked to prepare a circular letter for the next year's meeting on the subject of angels. Thomas Campbell's circular letter for that meeting was read and approved for distribution. The Redstone Baptist Association's meeting notes record an attendance for Brush Run of 39 members in 1817, 44 in 1818, and 49 in 1819. On May 21, 1820, Selina Huntington Bakewell would be immersed at the mouth of Buffalo Creek by Alexander Campbell. Unknown at the time, she would become his second wife after the death of her best friend and wife of Alexander, Margaret Brown Campbell. In August 1823, tensions between Alexander Campbell and some in the Redstone Baptist Association were mounting. Alexander was tipped off of a plot to publicly embarrass him in some fashion. This was prior to his upcoming debate with William McCullough. In order to defuse the situation, Alexander Campbell clandestinely moved his membership from Brush Run, Pennsylvania, to Wellsburg, West Virginia. That would be out of the jurisdiction of the Redstone Association. When the annual meeting of the association began, they inquired as to why Alexander Campbell was not listed as a delegate for Brush Run. At that time, Alexander explained and presented to the Redstone Baptist Association the following letter, which reads,
"Be it made known to all it may concern that we have dismissed the following brethren in good standing with us to constitute a Church of Christ at Wellsburg, namely Alexander Campbell, Margaret Campbell, John Brown, Ann Brown, Marv Sayers, and others are here for you to look at, too."
This was done at their meeting August 31st, AD 1823, and it was signed by the order of the church and signed by Thomas Campbell. There's a lot of important information here in this list of names. For example, we know that John Brown and Ann Brown also joined the church as well. Alexander was pleased that he was able to deprive his conspirators with this maneuver, but the tensions with the Baptists would reach a boiling point. Alexander Campbell had been attending the meetings of the Mahoning Association prior to that of joining with the Redstone Association. Interestingly, the Mahoning Association was formed on August 30, 1820, in part because the men of that association did not like the treatment Alexander Campbell was receiving after his debate with John Walker. The Baptists were pleased to rout the Presbyterians. However, they were disturbed by the line of argumentation Alexander Campbell used to accomplish it. By 1824, both the congregations at Brush Run and Wellsburg would no longer be members of the Redstone Baptist Association, but they joined the Mahoning Baptist Association. The Brush Run Church was expelled on September 3, 1824, from the Redstone Baptist Association. The number of members at Brush Run, which excluded the ones who went to Wellsburg, was reported to be 35 members. The building slowly ceased operation as a place of worship in 1828, with several going to the recently organized church in Bethany around 1829. The building was portable and sold to George McFadden in 1842. He moved it to West Middleton. It would later be used for multiple purposes at multiple locations until it was returned and placed at Bethany Mansion grounds between the mansion and the study around 1949. It eventually deteriorated and had to be destroyed in 1990. The timbers were stored underneath the Campbell Schoolhouse and forgotten about. Unfortunately, due to an oversight in 1992, these timbers were discarded. It was an accident that wasn't realized until about 2001. You may see photographs of the building, but be aware that these are not the photographs of the building as it stood on the Brush Run site. Some of the foundation stones were removed for the foundation of a museum in Bethany. For a while, a person visiting the site could see the foundation line of the buildings by the remaining stones, but this would fade away too. The cornerstone for Brush Run Building is thought to be incorporated into the Centeno Stone Memorial. We'll talk more about that stone as our biography continues. The first marker was placed here on June 30, 1932, which was replaced by a permanent monument on August 7, 1952. Now, as we continue in our tour, we're going to pick up traveling to the place where we think that Alexander Campbell may have been baptized in Buffalo Creek. Now, the actual site of Alexander Campbell's baptism is some distance away from Bethany and the site of the Brush Run Building. We met a guide in Pennsylvania who led us on our search for the place where Alexander Campbell may have been baptized. Our guide drove us down an old road off a beaten path until we could go no further, and we had to leave the van behind. We then proceeded on foot for quite a ways, crossing a field and some woods in order to reach the area believed to be the possible location for Alexander Campbell's immersion. Getting to this site was an adventure in and of itself, and we're thankful to Gospel Broadcasting Network's crew for going the extra mile so you could see this footage. I inquired with Historic Bethany about the certainty of this site, and they agreed that the exact location is impossible to determine with absolute certainty. We decided to give you an idea of what the area was like, where it might have looked, and where it might have appeared back in the day. All right, we're off the site of Buffalo Creek. Buffalo Creek is a major creek in the area. It's actually a long creek and empties out into the Ohio River. And there's a lot of places along Buffalo Creek that are interesting to see. It's a beautiful creek. We're here in Pennsylvania. This is probably very close to the site that Alexander Campbell met Matthias Luce for his baptism. He was baptized around this area on June 12, 1812. Now, when you're doing your research on the baptismal site, one of the things you want to keep in mind is there are two creeks in this area. One is Buffalo Creek, and the other one's called Brush Run Creek. Now, Brush Run is the name of the church where Alexander Campbell and Thomas Campbell, that's where they started meeting at about the same time they were baptized. Now, some people think there's another site out there that they identify, but one thing to keep in mind that Alexander Campbell said was, I want to be baptized in the same body of water that flows by my house. Well, that would have been Bethany at about that time, because he was married then. He lived in Bethany, and that's Buffalo Creek. And you also have to keep in mind where Matthias Luce was from at the time, and that's hard to nail down because since he's a traveling preacher and he preached in different places, it's difficult to determine. Plus the creek itself, I mean, you're talking about an event that happened a long time ago. You have flooding and things change. This is a dynamic creek. And so to identify a spot a long time after the fact is very difficult. But there are certain clues to keep in mind. One is he said Buffalo Creek, and this is Buffalo Creek. We're sure about that. The other thing matter is he said it was on David Bryant's property. Now this is, from what I've been told, this is David Bryant's property. Now David Bryant's property is quite extensive. It's a large area. And so we know that it was Buffalo Creek. We know that it was David Bryant's property. There is a mill nearby, and there is a remnants of a mill nearby. It's gone now, but I've been told this is basically the area that it's at. And so these factors, you can see basically what it probably looked like the day that Alexander Campbell decided he was going to be immersed. And it wasn't just him. He's the one that made the decision. I am going to do this. And then his wife, who's a Presbyterian, matter of fact, when he wrote about it, he said, my Presbyterian wife will be with me. By the time he said that to the time of this event, she had decided to be immersed as well. We should do a brief review of the events leading to Buffalo Creek. On May 4, 1811, the Christians reorganized themselves into the Brush Run Church of Christ, and on June 16, 1811, the Brush Run Church of Christ building was in operation. The subject of infant baptism had been discussed prior to the printing of the Declaration Address in 1809, but Alexander Campbell was not present at that time. As people continued to study the New Testament, more members of the Brush Run Church of Christ began to request immersion. Interestingly, Thomas Campbell immersed them while he positioned himself on the root of a tree. He did not go into the water himself, but he did immerse them. There would be additional requests for immersion to follow as people were searching the scriptures daily, just like those recorded in the book of Acts.
These were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Acts 17:11.
Keep in mind that at this time, neither Thomas nor Alexander Campbell had been immersed themselves. This would all change with the birth of Jane Caroline Campbell to Alexander and Margaret Campbell on March 13, 1812. Their first child. Interestingly, Margaret Brown and her parents were currently Presbyterians, as Alexander Campbell formerly was himself. So a decision was coming to a head. A discussion about infant baptism, also called by the Latin term pedobaptism, from a historical or theoretical point of view is one thing, but now there is a child, and not just anyone's child, involved. What would be done now? Would they proceed with infant baptism? Would they overlook the principles they set out to advance? It is a great illustration that the Campbells recognized the silence of the scriptures was restrictive rather than permissive, as some seek to invert it today. About this same time, Alexander Campbell was promoting the views his father wrote in the Declaration and Address. Alexander was not present when the men discussed the issue with Thomas Campbell prior to drafting the Declaration. He was actually trying to make his way to America at the time, so the subject of infant baptism was never brought up to Alexander Campbell prior, apparently. So Alexander Campbell was fond of bringing up the Declaration and Address to various religious people as he had opportunity. He was particularly fond of quoting Proposition Number 3.
Proposition Number 3 reads, that in order to do this, nothing ought to be inculcated upon Christians as articles of faith, nor required of them as terms of communion, but what is expressly taught and enjoined upon them in the Word of God. Nor ought anything to be admitted as of divine obligation, but what is expressly enjoined by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ and his apostles upon the New Testament church, either in express terms or by approved precedent.
Alexander Campbell decided to quote and challenge Dr. Riddle of the Presbyterian Union Church with this proposition number 3. Riddle told Alexander that he would have to go join the Baptists since his proposition eliminated infant baptism. Alexander Campbell was stunned. He attempted a response, but later testified, "I was startled and mortified that I could not produce one." He went to Andrew Monroe, the bookseller, who was at the meeting Alexander Campbell had missed, and asked him to order all the works in support of pedobaptism, or infant baptism. He was determined to make a defense of what he was taught on infant baptism. He sought to prepare what he thought was a preemptive defense for something they must have overlooked. The results of his study? Alexander Campbell would say this, "I threw away the pedobaptist volumes with indignation at their assumptions and fallacious reasonings, and fled with some faint hope of finding something more convincing in my Greek New Testament. But still worse, I found no resting place there." He went to his father to discuss the matter for several weeks. His father suggested that they should not unchristianize themselves, sort of like being grandfathered in. Alexander Campbell could not accept such a position based on his intense study. Alexander's conclusion was, "I now fully and conscientiously believe that I never have been baptized, and consequently, I was then, in point of fact, an unbaptized person, and hence could not consistently preach a baptism to others of which I had never been a subject myself." Thomas Campbell ceased debating with Alexander. The next morning, Thomas asked his son when, where, and by whom would he be immersed. Alexander replied to him and told him as soon as he found a Baptist to perform the immersion, it would be done. Now, Alexander Campbell had made this determination himself. He decided that he was going to be baptized the way they did it in the New Testament. Well, he went to go find Matthias Luce. Matthias Luce was a Baptist preacher. And Matthias Luce told him, said, "Well, you'll have to come before our group and you'll have to tell your story, and then we'll just determine whether or not you're a candidate for baptism." Alexander Campbell said, "I'm not going to do that. That's not a scriptural practice. I want to be baptized based on my confession that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I want to be immersed in water just like they did in the book of Acts." And Matthias Luce thought about what he said, and Matthias Luce was rather independent. And he said, "I think you're right, and I'll go ahead and do it, even though I may face disciplinary action in the association I'm a part of." He said, "Who's going to come?" And Alexander said, "Well, it'll be me. I'll be the one being baptized. My wife will be there. My parents will be there, maybe a few others." And so they agreed to meet along Buffalo Creek around this area for his immersion. And when Thomas Campbell and Jane Campbell came to be a part of the event, they brought change of clothing as well. And so it wasn't just Alexander Campbell that was baptized that day. It was Alexander, his wife Margaret, Thomas, his wife Jane, Dorothea, his sister, Alexander's sister, and a couple other people were baptized at this location on that day. And that's a very great day, a very important day, because he had talked about baptism several times. But sometimes when you look at something, you just don't see it. That's a really good illustration that you can read about more on a website, therestorationmovement.com. And they talk about some of the events around here. And I believe that's an illustration Scott Harp wrote about. Seeing it, but you just, you look at it, you just don't see it. Well, eventually he came to see it, and he obeyed it. And we're thankful that he did. Incidentally, they preached around 7 hours on this occasion, explaining what they were doing and why they were doing it. The following Sunday, 20 others were baptized, and more requests would follow. Those who did not agree with this eventually withdrew themselves from the Brush Run Church of Christ. Alexander Campbell would use this in-depth study and his Presbyterian background to debate those who once were of the same mindset. He would debate men such as John Walker in 1820, William McCullough in 1823, and then his last public debate with Nathaniel Rice in 1843. Although his contestants would not see the truth, hundreds and thousands of others would hear the truth defended and become immersed for the remission of sins themselves. The science of the Scriptures, as understood by Thomas and Alexander Campbell, is clearly understood by them to be restrictive, not permissive. To speak where the Bible speaks and be silent where the Bible is silent means you are looking in the New Testament for what it authorizes you to do Rather than merely looking at things, it explicitly tells one that they cannot do. Once this anchoring principle of silence is compromised, digression follows. It is an anchoring principle. Welcome to the Bethany Old Meeting House. This is a traditional meeting house, very beautiful, very simplistic. It's actually laid out the way that Alexander Campbell preferred to have a meeting house. We'll show you images outside, we'll show you images inside and all around. You'll hear the sound, the acoustics in the building will probably come across on the player for you. You'll be able to tell that it was built for sound, and you can have very few people in this auditorium, and it can sound like a very full building. Alexander Campbell preferred to have a meeting house where the stage, actually the Lord's Supper table out in front of me, was the focal point of his building. And what he would have people do is they would actually build a sloping floor. And so you might think that he's actually building the back of the auditorium so people can see him better, or whoever's delivering the sermon here, but he actually wanted the focus to be on the Lord's Supper table. As I mentioned out in Brush Run, they began weekly observance of the Lord's Supper, and that's something that they continued here. Every week they would observe the Lord's Supper. Something else that you'll notice on the outside is engraved in sandstone is the name of the building. It's the Bethany Church of Christ, and that's something to keep in mind. Some people debate whether he called a building Church of Christ or Christian Church or what names he would use, but he designed this building. This is the way he wanted a building to look, and so that's important to keep in mind. Now, Brush Run Church met from 1811 to 1829 out on Brush Run, but they would eventually come to Bethany. Bethany would be established around 1829 as a congregation here in town. And then they would build a building here, and actually they built the building on this foundation that's here today. The building was, I'll call it the stone building. It was used from 1832 to 1851. It was the first place worship site in Bethany prior to the old meeting house. This is where they would meet. Now this building, the stone building, the building before this building, Margaret Campbell never did see. So she never saw this building either. She had passed away sometime prior. Now the old meeting house, which is this building, is what we refer to it as. Worship lasted here from 1852 to 1915. And this is the place that Alexander Campbell worshiped all the way up until his death. Matter of fact, this is the only standing building that the church met in where Alexander Campbell had his membership that's in existence. This is it. This is the place where he delivered his last sermon. This is the place where elders were installed shortly before he died. This is where he would preach his last. Selena's membership with the church, she was immersed by Alexander Campbell, Buffalo Creek, incidentally, May 21st, 1821. Now, as time would go by, the congregants here decided that they wanted to build a new, modern, up-to-date meeting house. Alexander Campbell had passed away by this time, and they made the decision that they were going to tear down this building, and they were going to build a new church building on this site. Well, Decima Campbell, Alexander Campbell's 10th daughter, she basically rallied people to support, to sustain this building, to keep it here so people could enjoy it, people could come and reflect about the things relating to her father and the things that they accomplished. And there's a lot of great things in this building that are good for us to think about and to reflect on. Some things that you want to make sure that you make note of is the foundational stones around the outside. We'll show you some of those. When Thomas Campbell was getting near the end of his life, he was actually blind. He came to this location. It wasn't this building. He came to what was the stone church building, and he delivered his farewell address. And shortly after he did that, they tore down the stone building that was on this site and used the stones from that building as the foundation for this meeting house. So there is a lot of history here. A lot of people, a lot of ministerial students would come here, and they would graduate here. Incidentally, some people think that J.W. McGarvey preached here, But whether he did or not, that's a different matter. But when he was a student here, this building didn't exist. It was a stone building. So you may want to keep that in mind. But there's a lot of rich history in this building. There's four potbelly stoves that were new at the time. Now, the lamps that are around here used to be oil lamps. They've since updated that and taken out the oil lamp part of it. But they have preserved the structure, they preserved the fixtures and all that, and they've added electric lights that you can come and see. Now, while researching the contributions of Alexander Campbell that he made toward worship, I found this statement of interest. He had an 1828 hymn book that he made himself, and he had it published, as I mentioned, in 1828. Now, this is the one prior to the one that he had done with Walter Scott and Barton W. Stone. And it's interesting, I came across this statement that was made about Alexander Campbell's attitude about hymns and singing, and I thought this was significant. And this is from the Lakeland Christian University site where they talk about hymnals, and they made this statement. Psalms, Hymns, and Spiritual Songs, 1828, by Alexander Campbell, sized to fit in a man's shirt pocket, contains words only. During his lifetime, Campbell died in 1866, he refused to allow musical notation to appear in his hymn book, notation not appearing until the 1871 edition. He was a man of strongly held opinions about church music. He felt that notation appearing on the same page with lyrics would detract from worship. He was opposed to trained choirs. He was opposed to musical instruments and music for the sake of entertainment within worship. Now that's interesting that they would do that. If they had made that statement, that observation, you'll notice there is no instrument in this building. One of the nice things about historical documentation, when they went to restore this building, they wanted to make it as close to the way as it could as in the days of Alexander Campbell in his life. And to this day, there is no instrument in the building because everybody knew that Alexander Campbell did not worship with the instrument. But it's interesting, they seem to forget that it wasn't just his opinion. This wasn't some doctrine or some teaching that was unique to Alexander Campbell. Incidentally, he did make a statement about why he held this view. This is from the Millennial Harbinger, October 1851. He makes this statement. The argument drawn from the Psalms in favor of instrumental music is exceedingly apposite to the Roman Catholic, English Protestant, and Scotch Presbyterian churches, and even to the Methodist communities. Their church having all the world in them, that is, all the fleshly progeny of all the communicants, being founded on the Jewish pattern of things, baptism being given to all born into the world of these political scholastic communities, I wonder not then that an organ, a fiddle, or a Jewish harp should be requisite to stirring up their carnal hearts and work in ecstasy their animal souls, else hosannas languish on their tongues, and their devotions die, and that all persons who have no spiritual renewed heart should call for such aids is but natural. Pure water from a flinty rock has no attraction for the mere topper or a wine bibber. A little alcohol or genuine cognac brandy or good old Bavaria is essential to the beverage to make it truly refreshing. So to those who have no real devotion or spirituality in them, and whose animal nature flags under the oppression of church service, I think with Mr. G that instrumental music would be not only a desiderium, but an essentially prerequisite to fire up the souls to even animal devotion. But I presume to all spiritually minded Christians, such aids would be as a cowbell in a concert. Now, he's very plain on that statement, and people often ask the question, why didn't Alexander Campbell make more statements opposed to the instrument? And this is a little historical church history fact you want to keep in mind. When Alexander Campbell was a member of the Presbyterian Church and Thomas his father, it was against the law to have an instrument in worship. Matter of fact, most of the denominations of that time frame didn't use the instrument. Some people think that churches of Christ are the aberration, but the fact is the opposite. The denominations of Campbell's day didn't use the instrument. It wasn't really that big of an issue back then. And so that's why Alexander Campbell didn't have to write about it as much. But again, some people might think, well, how can you prove such a statement? The denominations had such an attitude. How can you prove that Alexander Campbell was more in the mainstream of that thought. Well, consider this statement. Now, this statement is by John Calvin. And this is what John Calvin said. Musical instruments in celebrating the praises of God would be no more suitable than the burning of incense, the lighting of lamps, and the restoration of the other shadows of the law. The papists, therefore, have foolishly borrowed this as well as many other things from the Jews. Men who are fond of outward pomp may delight in that noise, but the simplicity which God recommends to us by his apostles is far more pleasing to him. Paul allows us to bless God in the public assembly of the saints only in a known tongue, 1 Corinthians 14:16. What shall we say of chanting, which fills the ears with nothing but an empty sound? So John Calvin was very plain that he was opposed to instrumental music in worship. And he wasn't the only one. He's just one. You can find other statements of prominent leaders in the denominational period back then that were opposed to instruments in worship. And that's something that we need to keep in mind. But, you know, whether John Calvin opposed it, or Alexander Campbell, or Martin Luther, or different ones, what does the New Testament teach? That's really what it comes down to. That's what Alexander Campbell and Thomas Campbell and others were trying to get people to go back to. Some people will say, well, you know, instrumental music was used in the Old Testament. Well, that's true. There's no reason to doubt that. It says that very plainly that they did. But we're following the New Testament. What does the New Testament say? See, John Calvin sort of pointed that out. He said people go back and borrow things from the Old Testament and try to bring it into the New, but you can't do that if you're following the New Testament. And so what does the New Testament state? Well, in Ephesians 5, 18 through 19, it says,
"And be not drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for the things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ."
It also says in Colossians 3, 15 through 17,
"And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him."
Now, as time would go by, people would come along and they would move away from those statements. If you look at Ephesians 5, 18 and 19, Colossians 3, 15 through 17, if you look at them in other statements as well, you'll find out there is no instrument except for the human heart. There's no chorus, there's no choir, there's no solos. It talks about singing one to another. It's reciprocal, one to another. It's teaching. That's congregational singing. Incidentally, I often point out to people that the term a cappella, I'll ask them, what does the term a cappella mean? And they'll say, well, that means to sing without an instrument. And I'm like, well, that's true. That's what a cappella music is. But what does the word mean? And the word a cappella means, is an Italian term, it means to sing in the style of the church or the chapel. Well, what is that? Well, if you go and you research it out, you find out that is congregational singing. It does not have any instrumental music. See, a lot of people don't realize when they celebrate a cappella singing, they don't realize that the term a cappella actually has a religious history. It's tied to that kind of music. And that's the thing that Alexander Campbell and others would recognize. As time would go by, the congregation that met here decided on October 9th, 1912, to build a new building, as I mentioned. They were going to tear this building down and build a new one on top of it. But Decimus McCampbell stepped in, and others stepped forward and said that it should be preserved for others to enjoy and to be here to reflect on the things that happened here so long ago. It's a memorial to Alexander Campbell in the early days of the movement that he launched for people in this area. The old meeting house was repaired, modified, and renovated at least three times prior to 1915. Now, the structure is basically the same as it was then. It's been placed on the National Registry of Historic Places, In 1984, the building was in serious state deterioration, and several changes were proposed by architects, and they came and they did a major restoration project. They had a lot of work to do. There actually used to be a baptismal font in front of me. It was made out of metal. They had to take that out. Incidentally, if you'll notice on the sides here, you'll see that there's two doors, and the auditorium, the people would be facing those two doors. So if you came in late, everybody knew it. They often talked about teasing people if they showed up late. And that's something that, you know, people didn't like to show up late for church. Now we have it the other way around. We have the people coming through the back door. They can come in the auditorium all kinds of different ways. But in that day, if you showed up late for church, everybody knew about it. Another interesting thing about the building is the stone building before this building was actually facing the other direction. It was facing Buffalo Creek. And people would go and they would be baptized out there in Buffalo Creek. So this building here is a very special place. A lot of people worshiped here. A lot of people were baptized here. A lot of people heard the gospel here for the very first time. And we're glad that we can be here on this occasion to celebrate this night. Hi, welcome to Bethany, West Virginia. This is probably one of the more iconic sites in Bethany and really in Restoration Church history. We are inside of Alexander Campbell's study. It was built in 1832. It was built by a friend of his by the name of Louis Hobbs. And it was built probably the same time as some of the other construction that he was doing up on Bethany College as well. You might wonder about the size of this building. It's basically 15 feet high and it's about 17 feet across. Now, there would be an addition made later in the back here. Originally, it was a hexagon study, but they would knock out this back wall right here behind me, and then they would add a section in the back to add a window that would allow Alexander Campbell to look down at the mansion. Selena would be able to look up to see him. They also put a stove back here that he could use to keep heat in better. But one of the distinguishing features about this particular building is the light, the windows above. And he had this built so he could actually bring sunlight in, and it was really a novelty at the time. And a lot of people would ask him about it. And Alexander Campbell was a linguistic expert. He knew several different languages, French, obviously English, Latin and Greek and different ones. And he liked to respond in the Latin, lux descendit et calil, which is basically means light descends from above. And basically what he was talking about is the sun would be there, the light would come through the windows above him, and it would come down, and he would study from that light. And of course, he would use spiritual application as well. All spiritual light comes from God. All illumination comes from God and His Word. And so Alexander Campbell would study here. And as you look around, you can see some definite Gothic-type markings. Alexander Campbell went to the University of Glasgow. There's a lot of that type of markings there. He obviously appreciated that and incorporated it here as well. As I mentioned, in 1836, they did expand this study, and he was able to do more work here. He would write, prepare sermons. He would edit the Millennial Harbinger from here. He constantly had things going on. He was a very busy man. He would get up, he would have breakfast, and then, you know, he would already be here studying. He would go back down to the mansion. The mansion is just down to my left. It's about 150 feet just down the slope here is the mansion. So he would get up, come here, and he would work, and then he would go down, and they'd have their breakfast, family devotional and all that, and he'd head to Bethany College. He would teach there, and he would continue to do his work. Sometimes he would work till 10 o'clock at night, sometimes even to midnight. There's been reports that Selena would have to come and get him occasionally because he'd lose track of time because he was so caught up in the amount of study that he did. He had a passion for study and for learning. Now, what were some of the major activities in Alexander Campbell's life which he may have prepared from this study? Well, some of his debates had already occurred. He had some early debates. Well, that's already gone. But another major event happened with the unification of the forces under Barton W. Stone and the forces, so to speak, with Alexander Campbell. That happened about the same time that this study was constructed. And that's something that you may want to keep in mind too. Much of his writing probably originated in this study. He would prepare the Millennial Harbinger, which began in 1830 and remained in print after his death in 1866. The Millennial Harbinger would go out, it'd be typesetted, and it'd be printed. There's at least two houses standing today where the Millennial Harbinger was printed. He also had his 1828 edition of his hymn book, but it also had revisions that were done in 1835 and subsequently. He also had some of his books, Christianity Restored, although he didn't really like that term, Christianity Restored, but that's the title that the publisher put on it. He released The Christian System in 1839, The Sacred Writings of the Living Oracles, which would become known as the Sacred as the Living Oracles in 1835, The Christian Preacher's Companion in 1836, Christian Baptism, not to be confused with Christian Baptist, in 1851, Acts of the Apostles in 1858, The Memoirs of Thomas Campbell in 1861, Popular Lectures and Addresses, 1866, and he had other things that were going on. But he also still had some major debates that he probably prepared for here when he was in this study. Debates that he would have had with Purcell in 1837. Also, he had a written debate with a universalist by the name of Adolphus Skinner. That was actually in the Harbinger. It was a debate he really didn't, once he started doing it, he really didn't appreciate doing what he was trying to accomplish because Skinner would sometimes be rather crass in the things that he would write. Also, in 1843, he would debate Nathaniel Rice. It was his last major debate. Incidentally, it was with a major Presbyterian at the time. And of course, it was always interesting when Alexander Campbell would debate a Presbyterian because he had left Presbyterianism. And so he was very well able to identify with their doctrine, the things that they were teaching, and the things that were contrary to the New Testament, which is very important. Now, it's been reported that there used to be a bust in here of Thomas Campbell, and apparently someone had stolen it. It's still missing, but it was in this studio, in his study here, and someone broke in and took it. And so thought I'd just mention it in case some of you may find a bust of Thomas Campbell around. You may want to contact Bethany to get it back to him. Now, when I was a boy, I came to Alexander Campbell. My parents brought, to Bethany, and to learn about Alexander Campbell and Thomas Campbell. And I remember touring the mansion and touring the cemetery and all that. And there, you know, there's some things that I remember more than others. And one of the things that I remember was this study. And I always remember the idea of the light from above and the window and how impressive that was, how it made a deep impression on me. And I can remember thinking, you know, at that time, you know, don't they have a photograph of Alexander Campbell? Surely they have a photograph of a man, but you got to keep in mind that Alexander Campbell lived during the period before the Civil War. So even photography was rather rare. It's not like today, we have GBN here with us, they have great high-tech equipment. We're able to go places and film things in a very wonderful way and share them with you. But back then, you didn't have those kinds of options. And when I was a little boy, I thought, wow, wouldn't it be great to see a photograph of Alexander Campbell? We have several paintings of him, and the paintings are only as good as the artist that makes them. Sort of the same thing with pictures. They're only as good as the cameras you're using. But at the same time, I always wondered, wouldn't it be great if they found a photograph of him? Well, I found out later they actually had photographs of him that were actually made. And I thought, one time I'd bring tours here, and I thought, wouldn't it be great if they could ever find a photograph of Alexander Campbell in his study or outside of his study, because the study is really a major iconic emblem to me. Whenever I see this study, I instantly think of Alexander Campbell. And then one day, I got a phone call or an email, I can't remember now, but they called me and told me that an alumnus of the school found among the possessions they inherited a series of photographs. And the lady who was in charge of Historic Bethany at the time, she contacted me and she said, "You're not going to believe what we found." She knew I was really interested in it. And she called and we arranged, and I actually got a photograph that they found that even Bethany College at the time, from what I understand, didn't even know existed. So you just never know what's going to turn up. You just never know what might come about. And this is Bishop in his study. And if you'll notice, he's sitting down. And some people, they make a distinction about that. And the reason they do that is for quite a while, people thought that Alexander Campbell never sat in his study. This is an original piece. This is believed to be his writing desk that he would use in his study here. And as you can tell, it's just like basically a pulpit. And he would do his study and his research and his writing. But he also would sit and do some writing as well. So there's something that's interesting to find. And there's other photographs that they found of him in different scenarios and things like that. And they found other pictures of Bethany College. They found other pictures of other things about this studio is the idea that, you know, light from above. And I can remember that when I was young and the importance of that. And that's why I named my TV program that we do Light from Above. It's from this very room. And we still try to do what Alexander Campbell tried to do. We try to follow the New Testament to the best of our ability because it truly did come from the light from above. Okay, we're up in Alexander Campbell's lecture room. It's called the Academic Parlor today. This is a part of Old Main. Alexander Campbell, you know, when you visit Bethany, Bethany is just tucked away in a pocket of the West Virginia Panhandle. And today, you're almost stepping back in time. And yet, the university is still here. Old Main is still here. Alexander Campbell's home still here. He was a nationally known figure. In the day and age where it seems like a lot of people have forgotten about American history and our memories are diminished and everything, it's sometimes hard to realize the people of the past and how important they were at the time. Well, Alexander Campbell was a nationally known figure. And to be able to build a university like this and a building like this, you had to have a lot of great connections, you have to know a lot of people, and you also have to build it to the point that people want to come to school here. And one of the ways that Alexander Campbell did that was through his writing. He wrote a journal, The Christian Baptist. He also wrote The Millennial Harbinger. Since he was the postmaster for, it was Buffalo, Virginia at the time, but he would change the name to Bethany. He's the one that did that. The reason he did that was so that he could be the postmaster. And part of the benefits for being a postmaster is he could send the Christian Baptist and the Millennial Harbinger out, and you wouldn't have a major postage expense. And that went both ways. People could send things in, and he wouldn't be charged for it as well. Incidentally, if you happen to have the original set of the Millennial Harbinger, you may want to take a look at it to make sure you have a complete set. Because oftentimes what Alexander Campbell would do is he would send out the Millennial Harbinger, and then he would send a notice out, and he would tell people, send me your harbingers, and I'll bind them for you. So what he would do is people would send their harbingers back, and then he would bound whatever they sent, he would bind them for them, and then mail it back to them. Well, that would be a huge postal expense, but since he was a postmaster, he wasn't charged for that. But you may want to check, if you have an original set of a Millennial Harbinger, you may want to check to make sure, because you may have a bound volume where maybe an issue has a number missing, or maybe they're out of order, or a duplicate, because he didn't go through and make sure you had a complete set. He didn't necessarily go through and make sure that they were in the right order. Whatever you sent to him, he would have bound for you and return it to you. So you may think you have a complete set of the Millennial Harbinger. It may be an original, but you actually might be missing some issues. You might find that interesting to check. But in addition to his writings and the books and the translations and the hymns and the things that he did in politics, he's also a major known debater. He didn't have just little debates, maybe in a town or maybe in a state, but he had debates that drew national attention. For example, his debate with Robert Owen. Owen was basically he was a Marxist. I mean, Karl Marx didn't come along yet, but he was a utopian socialist. A lot of the people that espouse socialism in our day and age and communism, things like that, Robert Owen was of that mindset. And he would challenge Christianity. And incidentally, one of the things that he did was he made the point in the debate against Alexander Campbell. He said, one of the reasons why that I don't believe in Christianity is because you have all these denominations, you have all these different sects, and you can't tell me that all this division proves Christianity to be the one true religion. Now, a little back story to that. People didn't want to come and debate Robert Owen. As a matter of fact, when Alexander Campbell accepted the invitation to debate him, a lot of people were like, yeah, let him do it. Let Alexander Campbell do it. We don't want to mess with this guy. So Alexander Campbell stepped forward and he debated him. And when Owen made this argument to him, one of the counterpoints that Campbell made said, you know what, all this religious division that you're talking about, you're right. You're right. It does not prove Christianity at all. But I'm not here to represent denominationalism. I'm here to represent New Testament Christianity. And see, Robert Owen hadn't thought about that, and a lot of other people haven't thought about that. And so people heard his debate. It was a nationally known debate. It was printed, and people read it with great enthusiasm. A lot of people in our land today, they need to read that debate. They need to read about the idea of, is our country going to be a secular nation? Will we stamp God out of it? Or is it going to be more of a nation that's built on Christian principles? What are the true arguments that will tell whether or not our republic will remain a republic? It would be a good debate for you to read. But that wasn't the only debate he had. He also debated one of the top Catholics in the land, Bishop Purcell. In October 1863, Campbell was presenting before the College of Teachers in Cincinnati, Ohio. In the audience was Bishop Jean Baptiste Purcell, who took exception to one of Alexander Campbell's points in his presentation, and that was the idea of using the Bible as an educational textbook. Further discussions led to the men meeting January 13th through the 21st in 1837 in Cincinnati, Ohio, to debate. Interestingly, Purcell had previously debated a Presbyterian that would be the last person Alexander Campbell would debate, Nathaniel Rice. Nathaniel Rice was not known as a pleasant fellow to debate with. Alexander Campbell learned this from Purcell, so he really pressured the Presbyterians to pick another representative besides Rice. Now, Rice was not the first choice the Presbyterian Church chose to debate Alexander Campbell. The first contestant that they had become ill and was unable to meet Alexander Campbell for the debate. So, basically, after some discussion between the Presbyterians and Alexander Campbell, debating about whether or not Rice would be a suitable candidate, basically the Presbyterian Church came back and said, you're going to have to debate Rice or there will be no debate. So Alexander Campbell agreed to debate Nathaniel Rice in Lexington, Kentucky. When Alexander Campbell agreed to debate Rice, Purcell made this statement, quote, pending the long debate between these two really great men, my prayers were daily lifted up for Mr. Campbell. In his discussion with our clergy, he had always been kind, affable, courteous. Rice, quite the reverse. One was a gentleman. As to the other, what shall I say of him? John Purcell highly esteemed Alexander Campbell. In an interview, Purcell made the following statement about Alexander Campbell some years after Alexander Campbell had died. Notice these words that Purcell made about Alexander Campbell.
Now, as for Mr. Campbell's standing in future ages, I think it is quite within the bounds of truth to say that not ecclesiastical history alone, but profane history, will place him on the same pedestal with Luther and Calvin and Wesley, the peer of either of them. Had he lived in the early ages of Christendom and accomplished the wonderful amount of good with which he is justly credited, he would, after death, have been sanctified and canonized and enrolled in the calendar, along with St. Chrysostom and St. Jerome as a father in the Church, his name forever embalmed in its annals as a worthy successor of St. Peter and St. Paul.
Now this is high praise from the Archbishop, who had risen to become the highest-ranking leader of the Catholic Church in the United States at the time. Alexander Campbell was interested in the pursuit of the truth, not in merely making a name for himself. He was able to discuss the issues in the largest arenas with opponents who clearly had strong points of disagreement with him. By disagreeing without being disagreeable, the fame of Alexander Campbell spread, which resulted in even more students coming to Bethany College to learn from him. There are several beautiful pieces of furniture in this room, including the chandelier that is original and has been restored. There are five beautiful paintings in the academic parlor that belong to Alexander Campbell. These were painted by Edward Troy, around 1855, and they include such titles as The Syrian Plowman, The Sea of Tiberias or Galilee, The Bazaar in Damascus, River Jordan or Bethbara, and also The Dead Sea. These were presented as a gift to Alexander Campbell by Edward Troy in 1860. The project of restoring or preserving paintings is a costly venture. Around 1985, Stuart Trevenius Associates were contracted to restore these paintings. The project cost some $60,000. Four of the frames had to be replaced since the cost of restoring them in the deteriorated condition they were in was far too high. Interestingly, an appraisal was done on these paintings back in 2003, and their estimated combined value was in excess of $500,000. The Italian marble bust that I am standing next to was created by a Joel Tanner Hart. It was made in 1847 as a gift to Selena by Alexander. The sitting for the bust was done in November-December 1843 during the time of his last debate with Nathaniel Rice in Lexington, Kentucky. The resulting plaster cast was taken to Florence, Italy by Mr. Hart, but it was not commissioned to be sculpted in marble until 1874. The bust was presented to Bethany College and officially unveiled in 1875 on the occasion of the 34th commencement upon the commission of Selina Huntington Bakewell Campbell. The event is detailed in the Christian Standard and also in Selina's book, Home Life and Reminiscences of Alexander Campbell. The nose of the bust became damaged when it was on display at the World's Fair in Chicago. Alexander Campbell had many influential friends, including Jeremiah Sullivan Black, whom Alexander had converted and baptized in Bethany around 1843. Black was Chief Justice of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, Attorney General of the United States appointed by President Buchanan. He was also appointed Secretary of State by Buchanan and was nearly appointed to the U.S. Supreme Court. Because of the friendship between Judge Black and Alexander Campbell, Campbell preached in Washington, D.C. in 1857 with President Buchanan, Judge Jeremiah Black, members of the cabinet, and also members of Congress in attendance. On December 29th, 1857, Alexander Campbell, his daughters Virginia and Decima, and W.K. Pendleton were guests of President Buchanan and Judge Jeremiah Black in the White House. In the dedication of the bust on June 17, 1875, Judge Black was present and he read in part this statement.
As a great preacher, he will be remembered with unqualified admiration by all who had the good fortune to hear him in the prime of his life. The interest which he excited in a large congregation can hardly be explained. The first sentence of his discourse drew audiences still as death, and every word was heard with rapt attention to the close. It did not appear to be eloquence. It was not the enticing words of man's wisdom. The arts of the orator seemed to be inconsistent with the grand simplicity of his character. It was logic, explanation, and argument so clear that everybody followed it without an effort, and all felt that it was raising them to the level of a superior mind. Persuasion sat upon his lips. Prejudice melted away under the easy flow of his elocution. The clinching fact was always in its proper place, and the fine poetic illustration was ever at hand to shed its light over the theme.
And people would come and they would hear about that debate and they would read about that debate. Well, you know what that would happen? That spread his name across our country. Presidents, leaders, people all knew who he was. And they would want to learn more about him. They'd want to know more about him. So they would send their kids to Bethany, their students to Bethany, and they would study here to learn more about the Sage of Bethany. And this is his academic parlor. Also, we'll show you some footage of the boardroom, some great portraits that were made of Alexander Campbell and Thomas Campbell. There's also a bust of James Garfield. The bust of James Garfield is very important. Now, when Garfield became president, Alexander Campbell had died. But if you recall, Garfield thought about coming to Bethany as a student, but he decided he did not want to come as a student. He decided he was going to go to a different college. And one of the reasons he did that was because he wanted Alexander Campbell to take a stronger stand against slavery in the abolitionist camp. And Campbell just, he didn't support slavery. He abhorred it. But he just wasn't as strong on it as Garfield at the time. Garfield was very young, idealistic, and all that. Well, Garfield and Campbell remained friends all of Campbell's days. Matter of fact, Garfield, is his statue, his bust, is in the board of directors' room because Garfield was a trustee for Bethany College. There's a lot of great things here in the academic parlor, in the board of directors' room, and all through Old Main. And we'll show you some of these things and comment on them as we go along. But this is one of the busts of Alexander Campbell. He lectured in this room. This was his lecture room. It's a huge, beautiful room. And he would lecture to students. And you might think, well, I would really like to know what he lectured about and how he lectured. Well, he taught a lot of different subjects. But there is a book called Familiar Lectures from the Pentateuch. It was written by one of his students who probably sat in this very room, transcribed his notes and his experiences while he was a student of Alexander Campbell. And you can get that book, Familiar Lectures on the Pentateuch, and you can read about Alexander Campbell and the things he taught relating to Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And it's great reading. Alexander Campbell was one of the greatest scholars in the history of religious thought in this country, and that is still true to this day. The archives and special collections are housed in the T.W. Phillips Memorial Library at Bethany College. This library houses all the special papers and artifacts relating to Bethany College, including the personal libraries of Thomas and Alexander Campbell. The papers of not only the Campbell family, but also the Richardson and Pendleton family papers are kept here as well. There are many photographs, private correspondence, scrapbooks, and unique materials relating to the Campbells and Bethany College housed in this facility. One of my favorite accounts relating to the power of Alexander Campbell's preaching happened in the spring of 1824. Raccoon John Smith rode some 20 miles to Flemingsburg, Kentucky, just to hear Alexander Campbell preach for the first time. Smith had only read of Alexander Campbell through the Christian Baptists. Smith was struggling with the points of Calvinism and was attempting to determine whether or not Campbell was an Arminian or a Calvinist. After Campbell was finished preaching, Smith remarked to Elder William Vaughn that it was a long way to ride to hear someone preach for just 30 minutes. "Is it not hard, Brother Billy, to ride 20 miles, as I have done, just to hear a man preach 30 minutes?" "You're mistaken, Brother John. Look at your watch. It has surely been longer than that." Smith looked at his watch and, to his surprise, saw that the discourse had been just 2 hours and a half long. Holding up his watch, Smith remarked, "I have never been more deceived. 2 hours of my life are gone, I know not how, though wide awake, too, all the time." Notice the impression, not only of the style, but of the content. "Did you find out, Brother John," now asked Vaughn, "whether he was a Calvinist or Arminian?" "No," replied Smith. "I know nothing about the man, but he be he saint or devil, he has thrown more light on the epistle," talking about the Galatians, "and on the whole scriptures than I have received in all the sermons that I have ever heard before." Now, two factors were at work: Alexander Campbell's desire to present God's word powerfully, and Raccoon John Smith's thirst to hear the word of God. Some additional items of interest to be found in Bethany archives includes things such as Alexander Campbell's wedding ring. Also, Margaret Campbell's wedding ring here is here as well. It was given to one of the Campbell's daughters when Margaret's daughter passed away. The husband wore it for a while before it was donated to the archives. The whereabouts of Selina's wedding ring is not known, but we know that she did have one of her own. Alexander and Selina would celebrate March 12, 1812 each year, but he actually married Selina on July 31, 1828. March 12th was the date that Alexander married Margaret. Alexander would write to Selina on this date to confirm his love to her, and the family would commemorate the life of his first wife and Selina's best friend. Now, the two would celebrate their own wedding anniversary as well. On the occasion of 50 years from his marriage to Margaret on March 12, 1862, Alexander presented a special ring wound with some of his own hair to Selina in an informal ceremony called the Transfer of Affection. It may seem a little odd to some, however, one must remember that there were children from both mothers, and Margaret was much loved by both Alexander and Selina as well. Recall that Alexander Campbell and Selina's first daughter was named Margaret Brown Campbell. Thomas Campbell's printed copy of the Declaration Address to the Christian Association of Washington, Pennsylvania, 1809, is kept here as well. In addition to the personal libraries of both Thomas and Alexander Campbell, all the books published by Alexander Campbell, including an extensive collection of various other editions by other publishers, are a part of Bethany Archives, including in some of his books, Christianity Restored in 1835. Now, Campbell didn't like that title too much, but that's what the publisher put on it. Also, The Christian Preacher's Companion, 1836, The Christian System, 1839, Christian Baptism, 1851, Acts of the Apostles, 1858, Memoirs of Thomas Campbell in 1861, Popular Lectures and Addresses, 1866. Also housed here are copies of his journals, The Christian Baptist from 1823 to 1830, and also The Millennial Harbinger went from 1830 until after his death, clear into 1870. His translation of the New Testament he published, called The Sacred Writings, or also The Living Oracles, 1835, is here. Also, his hymnal, Psalms, Hymns, and Spiritual Songs, 1828, is located here. And also copies of his debates, such as his debate about Christian baptism with Walker in 1822 and McCullough in 1823. Also, his debate on the evidences of Christianity in 1829, his debate with the Roman Catholic religion in 1837, and then his last published debate, the Campbell-Rice debate, 1844. There are copies of those books and many other books that relate to the family and the life and work of Alexander Campbell are on display or a part of these archives. Here we are at Bethany Archives. As we talked before, Alexander Campbell was a figure before the Civil War began. It was one of the major events of his life. He came from Ireland with his father, and this is, you know, around the founding of our country, some of these events occurred. The nation's very young. And in here we have books of Thomas Campbell's library that actually came from Ireland. And it wouldn't be uncommon to find a book in this library of things here that actually goes clear back to the founding of our nation. One of the research, the first time I was in this room, they were doing a major research project, and they were actually trying to find a book of Thomas Campbell that they could prove had actually came from Ireland all the way across the ocean, was in his library, and they could document that it actually survived the shipwreck, because Alexander's the one that brought the library over when Thomas was already here. And there's a lot of fascinating things that are in the archives, and we're just going to show you a few of them, and then we'll show you some others as we go along. One of the interesting things are the portraits behind me by Bogle. This is the artist that did it. These are some pretty popular photographs, paintings that have been made of the Campbells. This is Alexander and Selena. And also some other things that are interesting. This piece of timber here is from the Brush Run building. Now, the Brush Run building was portable, and it used to be out in Brush Run, Pennsylvania. They stopped meeting at Brush Run and moved to Bethany, but the building was moved, and it served several different purposes, and eventually it became to the point deteriorated, it had to be taken down. And this is one of the original timber pieces from Brush Run. And they would also take, someone took a piece of wood and they actually formed a gavel. That's from the timber from Brush Run. And there's some interesting, I always like this one. This is from Ripley's Believe It or Not. And this is dated January 27th, 1972. And it says, Alexander Campbell, 1786 to 1866. It says, a celebrated American cleric preached throughout his lifetime without ever accepting payment for his religious work. He amassed a large fortune as a publisher, farmer, and businessman, and also was the founder and president of Bethany College. And so that's sort of an interesting tidbit of history about him. One of the things I want to mention is this cane. This is one of Alexander Campbell's cane. And it is photographed as the cane that's from that picture. And we can tell from the cane that he probably was less than 6 foot tall. But don't misunderstand his height as far as his stature of importance. One of the things that's interesting about him is he didn't use a lot of, when he preached, he would read text. And he's actually quoting it. And he would explain to people what the text was actually saying. He didn't use a lot of things that people would generally associate with great oratory. In other words, he didn't raise his voice really high. He made huge gestures and things like that. He didn't really speak that way. Matter of fact, he really didn't even prefer a pulpit. He had writings where he spoke out against having really fancy pulpits. He thought that those kinds of ostentatious things were really unnecessary and too much expense. What he would like to do is he would stand in front of his audience and he would lean on his cane and he would talk. He would talk and preach And people would come from all over to hear him. As a matter of fact, he would speak at least 2 hours. And people rode great distances to hear him preach, to hear the things that he would reveal from the scriptures. And people had a great thirst for knowledge. And a lot of people came to hear Alexander Campbell. And in the archives, we have a lot of great things that we'll be able to show and tell you a little bit about. There are 4 busts of Alexander Campbell that one will see on the tour. There is one in the Campbell Mansion, made from Alexander Campbell's death mask, and the one in the academic parlor, made in 1847 when he sat for it at the Campbell-Rice debate. There are also 2 busts on display here on the archives as well. The first one, the first Parian bust of Alexander Campbell, was created by W.H. Edge of New York City Pottery. It was modeled after an original by Carl Otto, depicting Alexander Campbell around the time frame of 1862 to 1865. It was displayed May 10, 1876 at the Philadelphia Centennial Exhibition. This other Parian bust of Alexander Campbell was also created by W.H. Edge of New York City Pottery. This one is depicting Campbell at the time of the Rice Debate in 1843. It was displayed also on May 10, 1876 at the Philadelphia Centennial Exhibition. There are several oil portraits of significance as well. There's an oil portrait of Alexander Campbell by William F. Cogswell around 1840 to 1841. It's 25 inches by 30 inches framed. It was restored by Stuart Treverius Associates in 2000. Also, there's a Selina Campbell portrait also by William F. Cogswell around 1840 to 1841. It is also 25 by 30 inches unframed. It was restored by Stuart Treverius Associates around 2000 as well. And then this oil painting by Robert Richardson by Wilhelmina Luce in 1904, it is 25 by 30 inches unframed. It was also restored by Stuart Tavernius and Associates in 2000. And then finally, this oil portrait of Alexander Campbell by Howard Roberts in 1872, it is 25 by 30 inches framed. It was restored by the same association, and it was invoiced November 18, 2000 was when that restoration was done. Now, I mentioned this restoration because just to give you an idea of the cost that's involved in restoring things like this and keeping them intact, I came across this example and I thought I'd just share it with you. The restoration of the 4 paintings that I just mentioned, the Cogswell, the 2 by Cogswell, the Roberts, the Luce, it cost over $8,000 in 2000 to restore them. That's $2,000 a piece in order to restore these paintings. So there's an awful lot of work that goes into it. In addition to those paintings, you have one by James Bogle, which was made about 1851. It's a 25 by 30 inch framed, and it's one of my favorites. I always like looking at this one. And then next to it is Selina Huntington Bakewell Campbell, also by Bogle, around 1851. It's 25 by 30 inch, and it's also framed. This picture, this oil painting of Thomas Campbell, is by an unidentified artist around 1840, maybe the 1850s. It's 24 by 28 inches, and it's unframed as well. In addition to this room, there is at least one other room that houses some of the rare books that are part of the collection, too. There are many great things in the archives to be seen, and we appreciate Bethany College for allowing us to come here and film on location so that you can see just a few of the things that are here that you would be able to study, research, and learn more about the life of Alexander Campbell. Here we are in what's called God's Acre Cemetery. This started out as the family cemetery for the Campbell family. You know, you read the book of Isaiah and you read an expression like a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The Campbell family definitely had their share of grief. As you look around here to my left, you'll see the children of Margaret Brown. They're just right down to my left here. As you recall, none of them lived to the age of 30. Now, Selena's children, they would live longer lives, and they would be married, and their grandchildren, some of their grandchildren, are buried here as well. But it all started with Amanda Cornega Campbell. She's buried just down here to my left. She died at a very young age, and Alexander came out here, and he picked this spot. And they say that one time when Robert Owen was getting ready to debate Alexander Campbell, he came out in advance and he met with him and he spent some time here with him, and Alexander Campbell brought him up to this spot. And then Robert Owen looked across, we'll show you some of the scenery. It's a beautiful place, and Robert Owen said, "There's no prettier place in all of Scotland. than this place. And it's very peaceful, very beautiful. As you look around, you'll see that there's a 4-foot-tall wall surrounding this cemetery called God's Acre. But the wall is actually 7 feet. They dug into the earth a good 3 feet, so 3 feet of it's below the ground and 4 feet is above it. Alexander Campbell's monument is right here. He's buried right in front of me between these two stones. His wife, Margaret, is right here to my left, and Selena is buried in between them. Now, some people may think that's odd, but you need to keep in mind that Selena's best friend was Margaret Campbell, and she loved Alexander Campbell. And so she lays in between them. There's also the child that she named after her friend, Margaret Brown Campbell. So that's important that we keep that in mind as well. Amanda Cornagle Campbell died in 1820, was the first death in the family. Amanda Cornagle, the Cornagle name was Alexander Campbell's mother's maiden name, was born on February 16, 1820 to Alexander and Margaret, but she died less than 6 months later on August 8, 1820. Alexander Campbell set aside this plot of land for her burial place. The loss must have been tremendous to Margaret and to Alexander, but it would not be the last. Before Margaret Campbell's death on October 27, 1827, they would also bury John Brown Campbell, named after Margaret's father, on November 10, 1822. And Margarita L. Campbell, who died on May 14, 1826. Alexander Campbell's first wife, Margaret, died on October 27, 1827 of consumption, or sometimes called tuberculosis. She was 36 years of age, and they had been married for 16 years. Alexander Campbell had her tombstone inscribed with the following:
"She was in truth a good wife, a tender mother, a faithful and affectionate friend. She lived the life of a Christian and died full in the hope of a blessed resurrection unto eternal life. The last lines she had sung declared her views and feeling in the prospect of death and the grave. No terror the prospect begets. I am not mortality's slave. The sunbeam of life as it sets paints a rainbow of peace on the grave."
One of the last wishes Margaret made of Alexander was to marry her best friend, Selena Bakewell, in order to provide a mother to her remaining children, Jane Caroline, Eliza Ann, Marie Louisa, Lavinia McGregor, and Clorinda. Alexander consented and thus married Selena on July 31, 1828. Their first child was named after Alexander Campbell's first wife and Selena's best friend, Margaret Brown Campbell. Selena and Alexander had other children as well: Alexander Campbell Jr., Virginia Ann, Wycliffe, Decima Hermans, and William Pendleton. Decima's name was derived from the fact that she was Alexander Campbell's 10th daughter. He would state of her, "Augustus Caesar only had his Octavia, but I have my Decima." The longest living child of Margaret's was Clorinda, who lived only 29 years. Before Alexander Campbell died in 1866, Selena would lose Wycliffe in 1847. And Margaret Brown in 1848. Also to die would be Margaret's remaining children, Jane Caroline in 1834, Eliza Ann in 1839, and Marie Louisa in 1841. It is difficult to measure the impact of the death of a child on a family, but perhaps the greatest impact, certainly upon Selena, was the loss of Wycliffe in a drowning accident on September 4, 1847. The grief from that loss nearly drove Selena to the brink of insanity. With the constant attention of Alexander Campbell, family, and friends, she did eventually recover and was able to bear up under this burden of grief. Alexander Campbell had the cemetery surveyed and willed to Bethany College at his passing. All of Alexander Campbell's children with Margaret and Selena are buried here, with the exception of William Pendleton Campbell, who is buried in Wellsburg, West Virginia, with his wife's family. He had married Nanny Cochran and operated a law practice in Wellsburg, and we'll show you a photograph of his grave in Wellsburg, where it's located today. Thomas Campbell and his wife Jane are buried here, as are Margaret's father, John Brown, and his second wife. Other prominent people of the Restoration Movement are buried here, including Alexander Campbell's biographer, Robert Richardson, plus several others relating to Bethany College. Selena died on June 28, 1897, at the age of 94, and she was laid to rest next to Alexander Campbell and Margaret Brown. Selena would be followed in death by her remaining children, Alexander Campbell Jr. in 1906, Virginia Ann in 1908, William Pendleton in 1917, and lastly Decima in 1920. Several of the children's spouses and children and other descendants are buried here as well. When Margaret Brown was dying, she had on her mind, among other things, the welfare of her children. And so she asked Alexander Campbell if he would consent to marry Selena. And he agreed to do that because she wanted to make sure that her children had a mother. And Selena had been in their home. Alexander Campbell baptized her. She was no stranger to the family at all. And so he consented, and they were married on July 31st, 1828. And they went on to have several children as well. It's also interesting to note about this monument. As I mentioned, Alexander Campbell's buried here between these two stones. This monument was put here in a tribute to his honor. And just a little bit about the monument. It was erected to him. He's laid to rest here. It's placed in his honor. It's an Italian marble construction that sits on a 2-ton granite foundation. And you'll recognize the architecture of it is very similar to the things that you saw at his study. Also, that you saw at the university, has a lot of the markings that he favored. And there's tributes to him on this stone, which we'll read to you in a moment. But there's also mentions of his wife and things of that nature. He was born in County Down, Ireland, and he came here and he became a citizen of this country, and he loved this country. Matter of fact, and when he was writing letters back and forth between him and his uncle, he made the statement that he wouldn't change being a U.S. citizen for the position of the King of England himself. And so here lies the remains of Alexander Campbell, where he rests in the hope of immortality. Now here is the resting place for William K. Pendleton. His actual name is William Kimbrough Pendleton. He's buried here. He's actually the son-in-law to Alexander Campbell. It's an interesting thing. There's a lot of interesting things about Pendleton, but one of the things that a lot of people find intriguing is he was actually married to two of Alexander Campbell's daughters, both from Margaret. He first married Lavinia, but as we've talked about, you know, Alexander Campbell had a lot of grief in his life. You know, he lost his first wife. He lost all the children that Margaret had. They all died before they were 30. And these are two that Pendleton had married. He married Lavinia, but she died after nearly 6 years of marriage. And then he would go on to marry Clorinda. And he was married to Clorinda, but she passed away as well. And so there's a lot of sorrow, there's a lot of grief that happened in this little cemetery that's documented here. William K. Pendleton wasn't just Alexander Campbell's father-in-law. He helped with the business, the operation, which is Bethany College. He took over the college after Alexander Campbell could no longer continue as president, which was he served as president until his death. He was also took over the Millennial Harbinger and the paper and other aspects of the business when Alexander Campbell passed away in 1866. Another interesting cemetery monument out here you want to make sure you see when you visit God's Acre here in Bethany, West Virginia, is this one. This monument was put here in honor of Robert Richardson. He's buried here as well. People sometimes ask me, or they ask other people, what is the one book you ought to read about Alexander Campbell if you want to learn more about him? The standard answer is Robert Richardson's book, because he knew Alexander Campbell, knew him personally. Matter of fact, when Alexander Campbell passed away, Robert Richardson, he was the one that did his funeral. Also, Richardson sent a notice out in the Millennial Harbinger when Alexander Campbell passed away and announced that he was going to be working on his memoirs. And so he asked for people to send in suggestions and things of that nature relating to Alexander Campbell's life that he could put together and publish a book. And his book, The Memoirs of Alexander Campbell, is essential reading if you really want to learn about the life of Alexander Campbell from somebody that knew him. He also taught on the faculty at Bethany College as well. And he was a good friend of Alexander Campbell, the grave of Robert Richardson. The Centeno Stone is a collection of stones assembled from major events relating to the disciples, including, in order from the marker, the following. 1, a foundation stone from the original part of the Campbell Mansion. Then there's a stone from the house of Welsh, which Thomas Campbell lived in while drafting the Declaration of Address while his family was attempting to relocate from Ireland to America in 1809. Third is a stone from the Brush Run building that was the first church building built by the disciples here in 1811. The fourth one is a stone from Buffalo Creek at the baptismal site of Alexander and Margaret Campbell, Thomas and Jane Dorothea, Alexander's sister, and James Hannon and wife were immersed there in 1812. Fifth is a stone from the Wellsburg, West Virginia building that Alexander helped raise funds to build in 1816. It is also where he transferred his membership in order to avoid a scene with a faction of the Redstone Baptist Association that wanted to make a spectacle of him. The sixth one is a stone from Cross Creek, where Alexander Campbell delivered his famous Sermon on the Law, which began a battle with some of the Baptist churches within the Redstone Association. The seventh stone is a stone from Buffalo Seminary, which operated from 1818 to 1823, and it was a precursor to higher education in Bethany. The eighth stone is one that relates to Thomas Campbell's study. It was also used by Alexander Campbell prior to having his hexagonal study built. There was a study that Thomas Campbell used during that period. It was built around 1826 to 1829. The ninth stone is from a school building used from 1830 to 1840, where the children were taught, serving as a precursor to public education. The tenth stone is from a Millennial Harbinger building where the magazine was printed for a considerable period of time. The 11th stone is from Uniontown, Pennsylvania, where Alexander Campbell preached his Sermon on the Rock in 1826, which resulted in the final breach with the Redstone Baptist Association. The 12th stone is from Robert Richardson's home, Bethpage. He wrote the definitive biography on Alexander Campbell, The Memoirs of Alexander Campbell, which is highly recommended reading. The 13th stone is from the primary department of Bethany College. The 14th stone is from the stone building, which preceded the old meeting house, built in 1829, but replaced in 1853. The 15th stone is a stone from the Pendleton Heights, which was built around 1841, and now serves as a home for the president of Bethany College. The 16th stone is from the last home to be used to print the Millennial Harbinger. The 17th stone is from the house of Moses E. Lard, who attended Bethany College from 1845 to 1849. Lard wrote a book in review of J.B. Jeter's book called Campbellism Examined. It's a book that's still in print, and it's really highly recommend that you read that. Number 18, a stone from God's Acre Cemetery, sometimes called the Westminster Abbey of the Disciples, is included. And then number 19, a stone from Pleasant Hill Seminary of West Middleton, Pennsylvania of 1846. This was an all-girls school operated by Jane Campbell McKeever. The 20th stone was from the original college building, which burnt from a fire in 1857. Then the 21st stone was from the Hibernia, which was the name of the house where Robert Milligan lived, and also the Millennial Harbinger was printed there at one time as well. And finally, the 22nd stone from the Cane Ridge Meeting House, where Barton W. Stone and the Christians began in their leg of the journey back to New Testament Christianity. The lives of the Campbells make up an exciting time of American history, and people's effort to restore themselves to New Testament Christianity is really a thrilling story. Some are tempted to argue that Alexander Campbell sought to create his own denomination. He did nothing of the sort. In fact, his journal, The Christian Baptist, was a clarion call to abandon denominationalism and unite under what he called sometimes the New Testamentism. Some folks do not realize that the term Campbellite was used as a slur against Christians. Alexander Campbell always rejected such a label and resisted the idea of being a founder, as the label implies. He had to correct people about this on more than one occasion. For example, in The Christian Baptist, March 7, 1825, he made this statement.
Some religious editors in Kentucky call those who are desirous of seeing the ancient order of things received the Restorationers, the Campbellites. And the most reproachful epithets are showered upon them because they have some conscientious regard for the divine author and the divine authority of the New Testament. This may go down very well with some, but all who fear God and keep His commandments will pity and deplore the weakness and folly of those who either think to convince or persuade by such means.
It would not be the only time he would have to make such a statement. He also made this statement in The Christian Baptist in 1828.
A correspondent in Kentucky asked me what Campbellism is, to which I answer, it is a nickname of reproach and invented and adopted by those whose views, feelings, and desires are all sectarian, who cannot conceive of Christianity in any other light
than an ism.
Why would people use labels such as Campbellism or call people that follow the New Testament Campbellites? Why would they do that? Well, Alexander Campbell, through his writings, translation, publishing, teaching, and debating, he was very effective. So effective in his day that his critics would have to resort to basically old-fashioned playground tactics, name-calling. Occasionally I read statements that Alexander Campbell was an ecumenical leader. It depends on how one is defining the term ecumenicalism. According to dictionary.com, the term ecumenicalism is, quote, the aim of unity among all Christian churches throughout the world. In one sense, Alexander Campbell would agree with such a label. However, the concept of unification at the expense of compromising the New Testament doctrine is not something that Alexander Campbell would promote. He would not subscribe to the join the church of your choice approach. He would have called on all to give up their parties, their creeds, their denominational garb, and unite on the New Testament alone. In other words, let us speak where the Bible speaks. Be silent where the Bible is silent. Let us do Bible things in Bible ways. Call things by Bible names. In matters of faith, unity. In matters of opinion, liberty. In all matters, love. Let us take the Bible as our only God. We're out here in front of Old Main at Bethany College, and this is one of the monuments that some people comment that it's one of the forgotten monuments. So it's very important, and we're going to conclude our discussion about Alexander Campbell with this monument. And the reason being, as you'll see, is there's actually several stones. This is called the Centeno Stone. It was laid here in commemoration of the 100-year anniversary of Bethany College. All right, so as you can see from all the events that happened, the Centeno Stone, one of the great things about it, it really ties together all the major events, some of which you've seen, some of which we weren't able to show you. But you can see how important a stone like this is to tie all the events that relates to Bethany together. One of the teachers that inspired me to study about Alexander Campbell was a man by the name of Basil Wolverton. And one time he made this statement, and I want to share the statement with you before we close the program. He said, "Many mistakes have been made in the Restoration Movement, but the Restoration plea is not a mistake, but it is a complete harmony with what the New Testament requires." And that's what Alexander Campbell, Thomas Campbell, Barton W. Stone, and men before them and men to come after them would be pleading for people to do, to get away from creeds, from denominations, from creed books and manuals, and just follow the New Testament. Just follow Christ's word and do the things as Christ would have them to do. And that's what we try to do even to this day. Thanks for watching our program. We hope you've enjoyed the sights and the things that we've had to present here with you.
Upon the banks of Jordan stood the great reformer John, and pointed to the Lamb of God, the long expected one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis the blood of Jesus, the crucified one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. He bade all those who did repent forthwith to be immersed, assuring them that God had sent the message he rehearsed. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis the blood of Jesus, the crucified one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. But now the reign of God has come, that reign of grace below, and Jesus reigns upon God's throne, remission to bestow. Now I see the blood of the Lamb,
of the Lamb.
Now I see the blood of the Lamb.
It's
the blood of
the
blood of the Lamb. He bids all nations look. sense of life and peace, and offers pardon to all them who now accept his grace. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis the blood of Jesus, the crucified one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis the blood of Jesus, the crucified one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis the blood of Jesus, the crucified one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. Now I see the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis the blood of Jesus, the crucified one. Now I see the blood of the Lamb.
Got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow